valuable books.
Right?
and start with this book I've been reading that these authors are going to, hopefully this Skype will work, are going to be talking. This book is, I've been reading this book called The New Universe of the Human Future, which is, I'll talk about later on, but it connected deeply with me about that sort of primary question, the central question about how does an artist survive? And so I want, and that the book is also, it sort of talks about this, the symmetry between the past and the future, and sort of the connection between one's ability to understand, to be sensitive to the past, connected and corresponding to how we envision the future. So with that in mind, I wanted to sort of start by going back a little bit in my own personal history to a question that I had when I first stumbled upon this crazy place and met Stacy and Carlos, which is, and it's a question that many of the artists, the young emerging artists that come here ask, which is, how do you survive as artists? How do you do this? And I didn't even realize I was asking this question when I first came here. I had even given up the idea of being an artist, so I was mostly here as a curiosity. And I was perhaps following some map that I had either inherited or that had been, maybe that was written by predominant circumstances, or an itinerary. And the first question that was posed to me, I think it was by Stacy, that I hadn't thought of, and I think it's interesting that I hadn't thought of this question, but the question was, why not travel without an itinerary? And that really shook my thinking in a way, because I was following some sort of map to some buried treasure, and that map I hadn't completely authored on my own. And this question of, well, really, who drew this map? What are the values represented by this map? There were some geographical locales to this map, like cities I should perhaps go to, connected to resources I should perhaps tap into in order to do something that will connect me to some larger meaning. And even that, I think, was unspoken inside of myself, that there was a desire and a need to tap into larger meaning. This curveball was thrown to me, which was, why don't you travel without an itinerary? That map, in a way, you could say is also, maybe it's a map of values, or a map of cities, or a map of resources, but it's also a map of meaning. As Bruno Schultz writes, meaning, our reality is our meaning, basically. The essence of our reality is meaning. The first thing that occurred to me was that I needed to be in a space where I could actually be researching and thinking about meaning. That I didn't necessarily need to be running to a place to make something. I needed to be running to a place that had conducive conditions for me to actually have some revelation. That's actually where there perhaps might be some value first before anything else. This led to thinking about how do you have these conditions on a long-term basis? How do you coalesce the conditions for research with the conditions, the basic conditions of survival, whether it's individual survival or if you have a family or a community that you feel responsible for? These questions, and I should have known that the question posed to me really wasn't, why not travel without an itinerary? But I'm realizing 13 years later, why not you travel with a different itinerary, like double-edged itinerary. it's so malleable.
All the good cards.
So this question about coalescing, it became clear that the conditions for the artistic research were inexorably connected to the process, and that the process, as we all know, is the product. So then it became, for me, this questioning of, well, first, what are the conditions that I need? But then it led to, of course, the group's conditions, the community, the ecology, and so on. This larger context, just, you know, over the years, has been inescapable. The essay that Schultz quote is from is called "The Mythologization of Reality," and it's in a collection called "The Regions of Great Heresy." And I stumbled on the etymology of heresy, which is from Greek, which is choice, which I found very interesting. And that, as heretics are questioning conventional choices and conventionalism. And I think, based on the people that are in this room, that we would agree that conventionalism has failed most of us, has failed us in terms, in many ways, the environment, the economy, artistic conditions, and so on. So I'm sort of honored and proud to have gathered a group of heretics in the room as a way of sharing. I mean, the purpose of this really is sharing and thinking. I hope to keep this frame very loose with that in mind. My desire was to gather people like you who are pushing up against conventionalism in different ways, and across areas, and across sectors, and across disciplines. I think by gathering sort of tribal leaders, we get the sense of tribes, and we get the sense then of the values of those tribes and the ecosystems in which those tribes exist. A constellation gets drawn, and a constellation doesn't only represent a pattern, a seasonal pattern, but ultimately ends up representing a narrative and or a myth. So I hope by creating a constellation with the people that are in this room, we in fact create new meaning, or at least reveal it, even though we know it exists, in new light and illuminate it, and, you know, subtly have effect on the reality, first and foremost. But then also discuss more concretely, perhaps, what our work is, what our work has been, and what's a way of seeing it, a new narrative that will uncover resources that we didn't know existed, or that we knew existed, but we hadn't given a name, or that we hadn't named in a certain way. Or that these resources that we know fuel our work and make our work alive, perhaps aren't part of the common language, the conventional language of resources. That's my big frame. I had the thought, again, I think when I was reading this book, that if you were going to have successful, broad, you know, true cross-sector collaborations, everybody needed to be involved, not just one entity, but there needed to be sort of some deep buy-in, some deep dialogue. So the idea of today was thinking that we would have these sort of lenses. I know people have been confused about not only where do I sit, but when do I speak and how is this working. I hesitated to use the word panels because I'd like it to be a conversation. I'd like it to be fluid and interruptive even. I did want to think about specific frames, and I had the great fortune of working with Amrita and Javiera and Polly and RJ and Morgan and Michael, who's delayed but will be here this afternoon, Michael Rohd, in contemplating these sort of frameworks, these lenses, which I think are vital ones. But they're not so exclusive. I think many people are in many overlappings. But as they relate to artistry, the focus of how we evolve the art first, and the artist and the survival of the artist, the frame of activism that is driven by art at its core, but that is tackling and fighting the different fronts to affect change in different areas. And then the area of cross-sector collaboration, where there's very new experiments happening, or perhaps ancient for that matter, that is finding new ways of galvanizing creatively and bringing sort of creativity to the forefront of everyday life. I hope this framework is somehow helpful. We have today and tomorrow, we'll go sort of go in an order, but also let it wander a bit. I wanted to thank also and acknowledge that there have been people that have, or organizations that have helped contribute to this event, such as TCG, such as Arts for Democracy, Animating Democracy, NET. Am I forgetting any? And HowlRound and Arts Emerson, of course. So I just want to give a shout out to them. Any questions at this time? Great. I want to pass it over to Hannah, so you can do some any logistical housekeeping things. This is being web streamed, by the way. So make sure there's no food in your teeth.
And also on the note of web streaming, if you have whatever electronic devices you have with you, I'm sure there will be moments that you'll want to be in and out and have access to the internet. That's great, but if we can minimize the searching that's happening, it'll help with the web streaming. So, also, just wanted to say hello, welcome. If you have any questions or needs or finding things, let myself or Joanna know, or you can see many of the members of Double Edge all around you. You can find me either here with you or in the front office. The washrooms are also in that area. We're going to do some tours later so you can really see the whole of the farm and the theater here. But don't hesitate to ask if you need anything that's not yet clear.
Great. We also have a materials table, which just has a few things. But if you'd like to add to it, let Hannah know and we'll print it out. There's some books. There's an article also by Aaron Lensman that sent to me, which is great and very relevant. I mean, there's, you know, an excess of materials at our disposal, but if you'd like to check out some of those things. Javiera.
Great. Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Javiera, and most of you, not all of you, and we decided that to kick it off, we would spend some time doing introductions, which is a little bit of a risky business with a group this size and with the limited amount of time we have, but we really felt like there were enough people here who didn't know each other and that we would benefit from just hearing a little bit about everybody's work. So we're gonna spend the next hour doing intros, and everybody's gonna get 2 minutes or less to share who they are, what your work is, and what brings you to the work. And I think that last question is kind of the most important part. It's really what motivates you, what drives you, why do you do what you do in the world? And I'm gonna time everybody. You gotta stay on track. And so, little taskmaster over here. So I think you will hear something like this when you're So, Polly, would you be down to pick it up? And then we're just gonna circulate around the room.
I'm a plant, but I'm really I'm Polly Carl, and I am the director, editor of HowlRound, and also part of the creative team at Arts Emerson at Emerson College in Boston. And first, I just want to say, if you've been following HowlRound in the last week or two, I will not be apologizing this weekend at all. So I just want to throw that out there. The other thing, I guess a couple of things brings me to the work. The biggest thing for me is I keep looking for a frame within which to work that is as that reflects the values of the work itself. So my work has always been centered around creating a frame that reflects what I believe about the work. And I have found that to be based on the idea that there are some things in the world that are true. I want to believe that. And so I keep looking for what those true things are to try to create frames within which other people can work that feel holistic to the work itself. And then I just say a couple things this summer. That's been a huge struggle for me, the disjuncture there in my life. And the two things that have proven to be true, one has been a project that I've been working on for some time now about a one-woman, it's a It's a one-woman boxing show, and it's a grueling and beautiful piece of work, and the process of making it has been true to the values of the piece. And then the other thing that has been true this summer is that I made a commitment a couple years ago that every summer I would think of biking and theater as equally of the same value. And so those two things have been true for me this summer. So I've been in the disjuncture of the frame and the work not being in sync. I've been thinking a lot about the things that have been true. So that's where I am today. And I will talk a lot about biking in advance for that.
You said you weren't going to apologize.
Oh no, I take my apology back. See what I mean? It's like ingrained in me. I'm sorry. And I'm not. Oh.
So why don't we go around this table, and then we'll move on.
I'm Adrienne Petrillo. I'm the program manager for presenting and touring at the New England Foundation for the Arts. Some of you may know us from different kinds of intersections. We provide grant funding, but also services. And despite our name, we actually work nationally. Many of you I know are familiar with the National Theater Project. I actually manage our regional grant making programs, and sort of the mission I guess we operate under is that we are a grant maker and those resources are an important part of what we do, but also that we are here as a service and trying to connect people, convene people, get a pulse of what's happening out there, what are the needs, and where are our strengths that we can help meet some of those needs. So that is the approach that we take and I personally take in our work.
I'm Vijay Matthew. I work with Polly at HowlRound. And what brings me to the work is really trying to reimagine what resources are. And a lot of that has to do with figuring out the best ways to, or really effective ways to use the internet. So it's really about reimagining what resources can be and trying to make what's now invisible, visible.
Great, thank you. I'm Susan Clampett, I'm from Washington, D.C. And I've been working on this for 50 years or more. Right now, I am working on an affordable housing project for artists in Washington, D.C. I'm a grant maker in that I am on the Washington, D.C. Commission, Arts Commission. So we support artists and arts organizations in collaborative efforts within the city. I'm a board member at Arena Stage, the theater in Washington, and working with a number of other theaters. I was very interested in, particularly in the piece in the Art and Survival Convening quotes, because I really was in the middle of the culture wars in 1995 when the Gingrich Congress came in, and I was the deputy chair of the National Endowment for the Arts and in charge of all the program disciplines, so my portfolio was the grant money. And it went from 100 million to 40 million overnight. It required firing half the staff and cutting out major programs and money to artists. I think that has been, continues to be the most traumatic period of my professional life. And I've been just trying to deal with that ever since. Some of you weren't even in the field at the time, but I'd be really interested in hearing about what effect that has had, and what have we done as artists and art leaders to finish it.
I'm sure you'll talk about it.
No, and how the resources have shifted, are they shifting, what do we need, because the House just passed this week the same thing, so going down to $75 million with the Senate, and the White House will do something about it, but it's rough out there.
Thank you.
Let's
move on to that table, Amrita, if you want to kick it off.
Sure, yes. Hi, everyone. My name is Amrita Ramanan, and I'm currently an artist in residence at Double Edge Theater. I would say what draws me to the art is very much finding or obtaining a sense of connectivity with art and communities. I'm really curious just how the creative process becomes one in the community, and have been really fortunate that my experience at Double Edge has taught me a lot about that exploration. And with that too, just kind of the sense of, as a society, as we go towards growing diversification and what I hope is inclusion, even if that's more in the dream, that's still the vision I see, how that can connect to the arts and how we as a field can really push that forward.
Thank you. All right. I'm Laura Zabel. I'm from Springboard for the Arts in Minnesota. Springboard is an organization, we define it as a community development organization that happens to be run by 15 practicing artists. We're based both in the urban area of the Twin Cities and a rural community called Fergus Falls. And our programs are in equal measure about how do we think about artists making a living and a life in ways both practical and sort of spiritual, and how do we help communities better tap into and access and ask more from their artists. I am drawn to and pulled in this work, I think there's sort of two core things for me. One is a real sort of interest and deep passion for reciprocity and how we create relationships in community that feel equal in value and in contribution and in demand. And I think very important to me is optimism and a sort of sense of transformational possibility that this work is possible and that change is possible and that that we can find those moments of love and connection and cooperation, at least at a small scale.
My name is Clyde Valentini, Executive Director of High Arts, formerly known as the Hip Hop Theater Festival. We still produce the Hip Hop Theater Festival, which primarily helps to present new emerging work from the hip hop generation, plural, because, you know, there's a wide range of folks now creating that work in terms of age and demographics and background. And the reason why we changed the name is that we just opened the space about a year ago in East Harlem. Some of you have been there. And it's a small storefront, you know, and it's the first time as an itinerant organization who's collaborated with large and small institutions that we have our own space. It's about 300 square feet. It's, you know, an interesting block where, you know, we have market rate housing, doorman buildings with shuttles express to 86th and Lex. And then we have, you know, public housing literally right across the street. So it really reflects kind of like this economic diversity that's pretty interesting in a changing community. But what's brought me to the work and what's kind of informed the transition, even or informed me the transition from Hip Hop Theater Festival, the High Arts, is access, you know, to stories that are important to tell, as far as we're concerned, in terms of stories that reflect folks who are often on the margins or the fringes, or who don't get to see themselves on either stages or screens, or, you know, even the internet now, which is kind of democratized, you know, people's ability to, you know, tell their own stories. So, High Arts is focused more on the development and production of work, and that's something that, you know, I'm really excited about as we move into the future.
Thank you. My name is Marty Pottinger. I've been a part of theater making since I was a kid, and tried to leave it for 10 years and was unsuccessful. Started again in 87. I was inspired by watching, I did a project called Abundance about America and money, and I got to interview heaps of millionaires and minimum wage workers and ask them the same questions, and have thousands of people in dialogues, and I asked each person to make a small poem in answer to a question, and I watched the transformation among thousands of people from all walks of life together in each room time after time, and I realized that it wasn't just me in theater, that it was something about human beings and making art that opened up something that existed in no other place, and that it's that powerful, which you all know. And so I'm an activist all my life, somewhat traditionally a political activist. And so I started something called Art at Work, and it's to tackle municipal problems in cities with arts projects. So the police had low morale, and it took a year, but they agreed to write poetry, and they were partnered one-on-one with professional poets and wrote poems about their lives, and it really changed the community's expectations of their relationships with them, and it changed them. I said, once they realized it didn't turn them gay, twice as many volunteered the next year. And so I left New York City 6 years ago and moved to Portland, Maine, so I actually work in City Hall. I'm on the city manager's staff. And what brought me to this is that I'm just excited about the times and what we have a shot at in the next many decades, and see the arts and creating it in a different way with many, many more people as being able to really make it possible to turn scary situations into really much more deeply equitable relationships for the rest of us.
Hi, I'm Crystal Brown. And I'm really happy to be here. I feel like I'm a grown-up in here. Like, this is really big. So, I am a little girl from a little town in North Carolina called Kinston, and I started dancing because I really love people, and that's how I got to be around them, and they got to be around me. And then I got this really great opportunity to have a wonderful career in dance, which was kind of by happenstance, but, you know, kind of the way it was supposed to be. So I worked for some people who thought that art and dance was this, and this was the work. It wasn't on stage. It was how you get the people to take the medicine and the candy. So I worked for Chuck Davis and Liz Lerman and Jolly Willa Joe Zala, and I had a company in New York for 10 years called In Spirit, which gave emerging female artists the opportunity to come together and make work. And now I'm the chair of dance at Millbury College. So I am all right now, in this very moment, trying to figure out how I just grew up in this world and in this work. And I think I've gone from kind of like a muse to like a soldier in the trenches to a practitioner, and now I get to be, I was a little bit of a spy, and now I get to be like a resource corridor to try to level the playing field. So thanks for letting me come.
Thank you, Crystal. Let's move on to this table.
My name is Sandy Timmerman. I'm a Q staff theater in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We are very pleased and proud to be here with our long relationship with Double Edge Theater, who has been completely influential in our lives. I tied very deeply into what Matthew was saying about Stacy's questions helping to guide what and who we are. And the questions about, and one of the ways it was very important for me is that I stopped looking to the outside world to tell me what I should be and how I should make my work and how that was going to be possible. Because nobody's ever going to tell you and nobody's ever going to give you anything. So from a director to a playwright to the, we don't do funding. Why? Because we grew up hearing that funding was going away and away and away and away. So we had to figure out a way we were going to do it on our own in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And so we started building. And my partner, Richard, who is the artistic director of Q Staff Theater, had this dream and a vision that we would create, instead of going someplace to try to have them give us something, we were going to try to build something and have it be there for other people, as well as ourselves. And so along the way, we've developed our own work and our own theater company. and a restaurant and a homestead and all sorts of things. And it's amazing how many wonderful, brilliant artists are out there who just want to do it their own way. They don't want to go to Hollywood. They don't want to go to Broadway. They want to stay in Albuquerque and Mississippi and Massachusetts and create their own work with their own voices. And that is what has brought me to this place, this time, and this work, and this amazing group of people.
Me next?
Yeah.
My name is Richard Van Scowen. I'm the director and co-founder, along with Sandy, of Q Staff, like you said, in Albuquerque. I don't know what to add so much, but we kind of appeared at that same moment in time that you were talking about with the culture wars and the funding kind of going away. We kind of felt like, as we graduated college together in the theater department, that all of the former models were disappearing just before we got there. And we had been in a group in Albuquerque before we started Q Staff that was approaching kind of survival in that more conventional model of granting and things. And it just wasn't happening. So when we started with Q Staff, we started with a survivalist idea of theater. Zero budget, make performance out of garbage in our house, and then slowly started this accumulation where we have now real estate and rental income, and the restaurant that Sandy talked about, and we're currently developing a building that has multiple spaces that we're hoping to create kind of a neighborhood art center. And that's a mammoth project for us. It actually is going beyond do-it-yourself, which has been our epic for quite a while, and we're actually trying to expand now in the next. As far as what brings me to the work, I think on a personal note, I had a falling out with a very strict religious upbringing that kind of separated me from my community and my family. And I think I come to group work as an attempt to kind of put that back together in a matrix of meaning that I find to be authentic and kind of transformational. I think that there's that reach for something higher and further and more beautiful.
Hi, my name is Mark Valdez, I just had this moment. I was like, oh yeah. I grew up in Texas, and there weren't very many models to follow. I mean, at least they weren't visible to me. And so Matthew talked about not having traveled without an itinerary. It just made so much sense because I actually don't know how. It's kind of leapt into it, or I'm not quite sure exactly how it happened. But when you talk about religion, that I grew up kind of in the South and in Texas in a very religious family, and there's something about that plays out somehow in a desire to be of service, to serve, and. And because of lack of other skills, making art was a way of doing it. And so a lot of the work I've created is community engaged work, community based. I worked for many years at a theater in Los Angeles called Cornerstone Theater Company. I work now with an organization called the Network of Ensemble Theaters. And I think in each of these, kind of, there's this path of how to help, how to heal. That I think kind of is kind of a common thread in things, and how to make art. I mean, like I also like there's something about that process and. Creating an imagination that I think is also very central to how I got here or what drives the work. So that's how I got here. It's a constant kind of questions and learning, and that's the fun part. And yeah.
Carlos Uriana, I'm a member of Double H Theater, and I arrived here in 1996, so it's about to be 17 years. No, it is. Should I say it? No, it's not. I came from Buenos Aires via Knoxville. I think, you know, my grandma used to call me the heretic. And thank you, Matthew. Now I understand a little more what she did. It was true, although I kind of resisted. Also a very strict Catholic upbringing, plus British education, which is not a good combination. A lot of soccer, and which I'm not going to apologize for. But I think that what brings me to, and in Argentina, I did a lot of activism, and I grew up during a war period, and I created a group, Diablo Mundo, which is kind of still alive. It was created in 82, similar to Double Edge. And I think what brings me to the work, which relates to this heretical identification, is there is a deep desire and an instinct and even a selfishness or a sexual drive for the work. In the beginning, I was in many risky and dangerous activities, and then luckily, you know, I found this way to protest the conventional and to try to like Marty said, I mean, I think I identify with most of what was said here, so I couldn't say it's this or that. It's a combination of all these things that I'm hearing, like Borges would say, you know, in this multitude, I can see my face. So,
that's great. Thank you.
I'm Sarah Alden, and I live in New York for the moment, and I'm a musician. Yeah, I guess it's really inspiring for me to be here because there's so much conversation happening about a bigger picture, something deeper, and I think what brings me to the work that I do is connectivity, right? Connecting with people. Like Mark said, I think there's been a part of me that wants to also serve, like find a way that my art can make to be serving to people. But sometimes it feels like the box that I live in is like playing for drunk people. And that might be, and there might be some value. There's definitely value in it. There can be value in it. But sometimes it feels like a box and like you can't, that it seems like, it's, I guess my question is there something deeper that I could be doing that could be a bigger picture, serving for bigger picture. So I have curiosity about that and kind of checking out. I'm in transition, so it's really nice to be here and hear everybody's conversation about that.
Thank you. Let's go to the back table,
Morgan. I'm Morgan Jenness. I'm essentially a dramaturg and a creative advisor, which I guess means I'm an opinion monger. Howard Cotton had said everyone is entitled to my opinion, which I should probably wear, but I probably don't need to wear it. I've worked a lot of theatrical institutions, universities. I worked for the last over a decade at a couple of agencies. Probably the most formative part of my over 30 years was the 10 years I spent working for Joseph Papp right at the beginning, which really shaped a lot of my attitudes. I just recently lost my job, so I'm at that point of like, oh my God, how do I define identity and survival? The two things that bring me to the work, I guess, are more than two, but there's two encapsulations of it. One is social sculpture, which is the idea that Joseph Beuys put out that everyone is an artist, that there is a creative spark in every human being, that the very word art comes from the Old Norse word "ert," which means to be, is an art from Old English means thou art, literally. It is being. Art is inseparable from human being, and the human's creative spark is, the sole idea of social sculpture is that the human creative spark and the organization and the interactivity of that is at the core and of the center of gravity of civilization. So I really believe that. And being a pyromaniac, I like to fan sparks in and see fire. I like watching things burn. So the other thing is stone soup, which is the whole idea that's the depression concept that you're sitting in your apartment, someone has a potato going, I'm gonna eat this, an onion, a carrot, maybe you have a piece of protein, a pot, a stove. You can't do anything separately. You all gather together, and the person who has the table and some silverware, and you all make a meal. So the whole sort of idea of how to have inter and intra connectivity between communities is really interesting to me. And so as of 3 days ago, I have, I think, formed this entity called Distracted Globe Consultancy, which I will continue to opinion monger from, but also is probably going to be involved with the development, production, management, and touring of work.
My name is RJ Maccani, and I'm originally from Cincinnati. I've been doing paid and mostly unpaid social justice, environmental justice organizing for about 15 years. About 10 years ago, I followed my partner to New York, former partner, and about 3 years ago, I joined the Foundry Theater as their community programs producer. They created a staff position for someone from the social justice organizing world. So I still moonlight doing mostly transformative justice work around gender violence. What brings me to all of this, I think it's probably true for a lot of us, which is just experiencing both a lot of violence and a lot of beauty. And I think it's what we wrestle with as social justice organizers, and I think the most effective organizers are artists and makers. And so I really see that relationship there. And we're trying to figure out how to relate to all of this violence and all of this beauty through that. I think there are things that the arts access that, to be honest with you, a lot of hardcore organizers have a hard time getting in touch with. Things that are obvious to us, like metaphor, are actually really missing in a lot of spaces. I'm particularly concerned with the question of embodiment. How do we, as individuals, as collectivities, embody our values, our aspirations? At the Foundry, I manage and facilitate our collaborations with members of base building social justice groups. And I really question, how does our practice embody true collaboration there? Right now, the founder and I are in a process of how would the company itself embody our aspirations as a company? Looking at artistic rigor, a rigorous political engagement, and then actually having impact in the world. And and I think we're also really trying to look at this frame, which connects to the person to my right, which is a question of who has a right to the theater, and how do we create how could everyone that lives in New York City have a right to the theater in New York City?
Hi everyone, my name is Lenina, and I'm here because RJ invited me, and I'm from an organization called the Right to the City Alliance, and so we have 40 different membership-based or community-based or grassroots organizations in, I think it's now about 13 cities in the United States. And they came together around fighting issues of gentrification and displacement. And so personally, how I arrived here, I think I, you know, I've always had like really strong interest in theater and media and like how that relates to political activism. I'm a baby of the movement, right? So like, my parents were active in the Puerto Rican Socialist Party, and I was always, you know, carried around in demonstrations and things like that, so I've always felt very comfortable in those spaces, and then and a little bit alienated when or kind of out of place when I didn't, when I was in spaces where I felt like, you know, people didn't have a sense of like a common space or a space to engage with each other and be honest and truthful and have meaningful and relevant conversations with each other. So in terms of Right to the City in particular, you know, as being Puerto Rican, a lot of my family being from Brooklyn and seeing the city change so much over time, New York City in particular, and knowing that, you know, displacement is just an issue that's happening and is becoming a global narrative, and Right to the City itself is a global narrative, that's something that I feel like we should all be aware of and engaging in. you know, people all over from Turkey to India to South Africa are fighting for the common space, the public parks, public grounds, affordable housing, public housing. And so I think that we're in a place too of trying to figure out how do we just break a little bit from just this idea of like these silos we've created with, you know, other membership groups and knowing that there's so many individuals that feel alienated and need a place, you know, and then and how do we connect to this like global beating heart right now of a fight for this common space, common energy and all that. So yeah, that's why I'm here. Help figure that out.
New lady, my name is Vera Worst-Tarrant. I come from the Kuna and Rappahannock Nations here in the United States. The Rappahannocks are from Virginia, and the Kunas are from off the coast of Panama. People who know me, I've been talking to a few people, is that I'm an associate director for Spider Woman Theater, and part of Spider Woman Theater's work is working on methodologies to continue my family's work on our methodologies that are connected directly with our cosmologies. And meaning that our storytellings, our religion, our existence has to do directly to our connection to cosmos with not a Christian doctrine involved. And that is how I was taught. I grew up in theater, if anyone knows me. Spider-Woman has been my biggest influence, probably other than Joseph Babbitt on Stewart. I grew up in the theater world as a downtown theater kid. And so my whole life consisted of being around people who were creative artists and what does that mean to sustain. Within the last 7 years, I was asked by my community, and when I say my community, I mean my tribal elders, my chiefs, to take on the role of working internationally with the United Nations, the Permanent Forum Indigenous Issues. And I had to really think if I was going to take this because, let's face it, I'm just an Indian girl, want a job, you know. And I had to really think, I had to really start thinking on the political level and really be mentored. And Muriel Miguel, who is my mother, she's my biggest mentor. And I realized at one point, I have been taught that politics and art are not separate entities. They are the same in our communities. For me to sustain a survival is really waking up in the morning, basically, because I have no qualms knowing that the world is not fair, you know, and I say that all the time. I know the world's not fair. I know I'm a Native woman who walks into this world, and I walk into this world on my own land with a doctrine around me which has to do with Christianity. So being part of the UN made me do a lot of work and try to sustain community development. And part of that, the other thing is in cultural development, and how do we do that with theater? How do we community build? And a lot of the work I do is with American Indian Community House, and my husband with the Silver Cloud Singers and Dancers is empowering Native youth, empowering Indigenous youth, empowering women through theater, because that's the only way I know really how to to go into a community. We've written our papers and we've done all of that, but how do we get it onto our feet? How do we talk about it in the embody of the methodologies that Spider-Woman talks about, and how do we create? This year I was asked to be the global, the chairwoman of the Global Indigenous Women's Caucus, and I had to really think again, how do I put that in terms of theater? And the only way to do that is to do cultural events so people can see that cultural and survival and sustainability and community accountability are all connected. Water is connected to land rights, treaty rights. We're all going to be on this earth together, as my chiefs, you know, Orin Lyons used to say. And one of the other things, and he still says, and one of the other things he says, if you're not at the table, then you're on the menu. And I have to really think about it. You know, because if I'm out of this conversation, then, well, you know, I have to really think, you know, there's dogs barking, they're after me, you know. So, you know, and really talking about, and one of the other things is I started really connecting with Mia Yu from La Mama, and she was mentored by Ellen Stewart. And we started really talking about these cross-references of Asian methodologies and Native, and how we were both taught the same way. And oddly enough, My mother was mentored by Ellen Stewart, and she brought her into the theater world. So we started to talk about this collective. How can we get a collective that for indigenous work to be seen, to be heard, to be tasted, how can it be safe? So we came up with this word called safe harbor, to make so it would be safe for a native artist or an indigenous artist would could come in and say, I want to work on something. I want to work on a dance piece about my land being plowed down. How do I do that? How do I get somebody from North Dakota, South Dakota? And then talking about urban native issues, which is a big thing because I was born and bred in New York. And we are totally always off of our traditional homelands, but our big part of being an urban native person is sustaining culture, which is language, storytelling, theater.
Thank
culture,
you.
Dance. Thank you. And so that's what I do.
Thank you so much. Carlton,
I'd like
to get off this
show. Sure. My name is Carlton Turner. I come from Raymond, Mississippi. I'm the executive director of Alternate Roots, which is a member service organization for artists that are doing work at the intersection of social justice, activism, and creativity in the South. I'm also the co-artistic director and founder of Mugabe, Men Under Guidance Acting Before Early Extinction, along with my brother Maurice Turner. And we are based in Raymond, Mississippi. We grew up there and continue to live there on a small farm, not quite like Double Ed, but we grew up in the community, feeding the community and creating space in which the culture was about supporting a much larger vision than just ourselves. I come to this work because my father was a singer, grew up singing in the church choir, playing in the high school band, junior high band, and as a writer, my brother's a musician, and there was no one in the world that was telling our story. So we saw a void in terms of an absence of our image in the storytelling atmosphere. So we created the space for our stories to be told and for the stories of the communities that we come from to be shared with other people. I think this conversation about art and survival is really important. We, as a nation, have become really good at looking away. And we're a decade into a war, into several wars that we have going on as a nation. And I think, I was watching this documentary last year, and it was about domestic violence, and specifically around men beating women. And this beautiful quote that says, the only way to enforce a lie is with violence. And as a country, we are a country built on lies. We manufacture lies. We are all about lying and keeping lies alive. And we enforce that through violence, both domestically and internationally. So this whole thing about survival and about predators and prey and what it means to survive is really important in this moment for us to be thinking about. And art to me is not really that important. But creating a creative atmosphere and a culture of creativity that allows us to think about the systems that don't work for us but are working perfectly the way that they were designed for the people that they were designed by. And so how do we begin to create and help to support a culture of creativity to create the types of structures that work for us and not against us.
Mm-hmm. My name's Nick Sly. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana, and I work with an organization called Mondo Bizarro. We create original works of performance over long periods of time, and we collectively run a space for the incubation of new work called Catapult with three other companies. And I think I was brought back to the work because of my home, and similar to Carlton, realizing that there were stories and storytellers that were telling stories that I didn't hear anywhere else. But in particular, the thing that brought me back to the work the most was the Zydeco dance, or the Cajun dance, where you go to a dance and the level of artistry is world class, but the social function is clear and apparent. And that showed me an example of the work I want to make in the world, where the musicians don't feel an incessant need to talk about their artistry or their craft. They usually just like get up and they play. And then the community gathers and does something really amazing, which is they dance really rigorously. And it just gave me a dream for a type of work where the artistry had rigor and the social function was apparent. And I feel really fortunate to live in an area of the world where that can happen. And the other thing that struck me so deeply about that was invariably the better the musician is, the more of an internal desire they have to share their craft for the future. And it just made me realize, like, storytelling is the only medium for me that's beautiful and expansive enough to tell the kind of, or to illustrate the transformation that I want to see in the world. So that's me.
I'm Richard Newman. I'm a member of the Hinterlands, co-director of the Hinterlands, and based in Detroit, Michigan. And 10 years ago, like yesterday, I first showed up to Double Edge, or like 2 days ago. And so it was, you know, I came here as a student and stayed, was here for like almost 5 years, and it greatly shaped the way I engage with the world, my community, my fellow artists. So, you know, it's really always a deeply felt pleasure to be able to return, you know, and spend just a little bit of time here. You know, we're the Hinterlands. We're we create original performances. We work multidisciplinarily. So we're not just theater artists right now. You know, myself and our co-director are our theater artists, but we collaborate with you know, JIT dancers and sound artists and architects. And for me, I'm attracted to difficulty. So collaboration is a great difficulty. and joy, but I think, you know, what brings me to the work continually is these kinds of engagements with people who think differently than myself, and who come from different aesthetics, different processes, and how can we engage with one another. And that helps me think on a larger scale of how I can engage with people who are different than me in my neighborhood, in my city, in the world. So it's a way of focusing on the small to pay attention to these systems that work together. I love my neighborhood. You know, it's one of the most culturally diverse neighborhoods in America, and the kinds of provisional solutions that people come up with based on the lack of city services and like basic functioning government is pretty remarkable. And I see this, and I see people, I see this incredible artistry, you know, in my neighbors who don't consider themselves artists, but just in how they create these insane garden systems, just as like a way to, you know, grow food, but in this kind of situation that's not conducive to that. So, anyway, that's all really I could go on, but I won't, so thanks.
Hi everybody, I'm Rachel Falcone, and I'm based in New York. I am a producer, a documentary producer, of a project called Housing as a Human Right that tries to connect people around housing and land and home, and use storytelling for that. And then I'm also recently, with Hurricane Sandy happening this last fall, sort of started a participatory documentary around the storm that invites people to share video and audio and written testimonies around the storm, and sort of take this huge event that has affected millions of people and invite them to collaborate and share and create something together. I'm the daughter of a social worker, so listening, and there's nothing that pretty much wasn't talked about in my house growing up. Listening was a huge part of my life, and my father's a video editor, so the idea of sort of like finding the kernels of story in pretty much everything is also deeply a part of me. I think I've really, over the last several years, just enjoyed kind of being in this crevice of between the social justice organizing world that's constantly passionately fighting for change, as well as sort of this beautiful work of art and the power of amazing art to just be, have people be in awe and change through that. And it's kind of like, as you mentioned, like a dark crevice that's hard and challenging and difficult that we find ourselves in. But I also see like the family and the people that are in that crevice and working and doing this incredibly hard work grow over the years as that family grows and get to see people at these beautiful gatherings around the country. And so I think that's what keeps me there.
My name is Michael Primo from Brooklyn, New York. I work with Rachel on Housing as a Human Right, the storytelling project, and the Sandy Storyline project. We create, we do a variety of things, just exploring how we can tell stories around a variety of platforms and in a variety of settings. We've created like interactive installations in laundromats and other unconventional places. I have a background as like a political activist, social justice organizer, as well as a producer of theater and performance, motivated to this work by like chasing that endless fix of, you know, creative perfection that tells the stories I feel like need to be told and weren't represented in what I saw growing up. And so like many people in the room was always chasing that dragon of trying to tell the stories that represent who you are in your particular experience, but also create platforms for the community around us to tell stories together. I'm really interested and fascinated by collaboration and participatory creation and how we can sort of step away from the sort of individual product-driven capitalist market and model of art production and continue to like go back to sort of the way we were before the Industrial Revolution and creating things in community, with community, for community. I believe that artists are the midwives of revolution and that there is the potential for this dandelion fire to just keep blowing and growing things. And with the Sandy Storyline project, we're also really interested in technology. We're iterating and creating a business plan now to iterate the storyline platform to create simple, beautiful, elegant digital storytelling tools that can be available in a climate where there isn't funding for this type of storytelling and it doesn't fit in any boxes, but create a very elegant tool set that's available to other artists as well as community organizations that don't have communication budgets.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, I'm Aaron Ledman. I make theater and I also perform and have had kind of dual careers doing both, mostly with elevator repair service as a performer, and now I've switched mostly to making work. I'm obsessed by a lot of things. The last project that I'm just coming out of is a three-city production called City Council Meeting that definitely may or may not be theater, may or may not be Total Emperor's New Clothes, may or may not be the most transformative performance experience you've ever seen, depending on the night you see it. It's made up of local government transcripts that the audience performs with the help of a group of staffers, combined with a local ending that addresses a particular issue in the city where we're making the piece. We made it through long-term residencies in each city where we were, and we're going to a couple more cities over the next year or two. That project made me not care so much whether or not what I was making was theater, and the important things have become finding the right form to enact whatever questions I want to ask. And I'm also really obsessed with like questions I can't answer and combinations of storylines or subjects that I can't put together right, but that seem to lodge themselves in my brain or in my heart. So I'm starting to work on a project called Perfect City that is just research, and it's about how major cities all over the world are using seemingly progressive values to create places that are entirely exclusive to all but the very wealthy. And so I'm trying to do research by asking people who are experts at living on margins and people who are experts at urban design, and then also finding out how our responses as a larger public might vary depending on who's asking those same questions. And then on a very personal level, I feel like live performance and the misfits that make live performance sort of saved my life starting when I was about 13, and I went to punk rock shows in Minneapolis, and I felt like, oh, there's room for me in this world, and kept me out of a lot of other kinds of trouble that I was just starting to get in very thoroughly. And I'm also interested in the survival question because some of you saw Harold and Johanna. I'm partnered with a brilliant choreographer, and we want to continue to survive together and build a family together that is resonant for ourselves and for other people. And is impacted by our values and the values of the people around us.
Hi, I'm Ann Bogart. I'm the artistic director of City Company. And 20 years ago, I said to the members of my company, I said, I think I have about 15 or 20 essays to write, theatrical essays. And I can give you an example perfectly, because when Marty Pottinger over there said, she said something that could be a play, an essay, which is when you said that you did a project where you asked millionaires, multimillionaires, and the disenfranchised the same questions.
What is enough?
Great question. And then the part that got me is when you said, then you turned to them and you said, can you make a poem? And I'm really interested in the moment that she asked that question and what happened to both the multimillionaires and the disenfranchised. And that moment would be an essay. That would be a whole theatrical exploration. I could spend a year doing that. Fantastic. But, okay, so I did that. That was 20 years ago, and I said that. And about 5 years ago, my colleague, Leon Eaglesford, who's in the company, turned to me and he said, so what now? We've done all these essays. What are you interested in now? You can't keep doing the same thing. And I had to think very seriously about it, because that's what we do, is try to stay on the edge of what is real. And I thought, you know, gosh, this is a group of people who are so trained, they can do anything. But meaning the actors and the designers that I work with, I said, in service of what? You know, we just go on making plays? That's not quite, in service of what? And in thinking about that very deeply, I had to say, well, what is theater? And what distinguishes the theater from any other art form is it asks the very particular question which no other art form asks, which is, how are we getting along? And can we get along better? I mean, every play is about a social system that's gone wrong, and that it's the reconstruction of a social system asking, how do we get along? But it's not only that, it's like in the rehearsal room, how do we get along? Or is the audience getting along? Is the audience getting along with the actors? Yeah, right. So that question is interesting. And I thought, well, there's this group of actors who will not leave me. They just don't leave. I mean, they're really well trained, and they are a community. They have become a very functioning community. And I think when an audience watches a play, they watch two things. They watch, on a conscious level, the play, you know, the story, etc. But on an unconscious level, they're being hit with, who are these people on the stage and how are they getting along? So every company presents a model society, how things might be different. So if you see the City Company working, you watch a non-hierarchical society, and one gets that viscerally. So I thought, well, if this is a functioning community, it's just masturbation to keep functioning. So what interests me now is that this tool that is a company meets other communities and what happens. So we've done a series of projects. One was with Martha Graham Dance Company, like how do you work with it? And recently with Guilty Jones and his company, like that's really disagreeable at times. And we're working with Bang on the Can, which is a community, right? And we're starting to work with Ann Hamilton, the visual artist. So in other words, how do we cross the field to somebody else's fire and see what kind of tool, how much we can withstand? Because, and it's really hard because you've got a group that gets along, but when you get along with somebody who you are not, or even does an art form that's not what you do, starts to address that question all over again, how can we get along? That's what I'm working on right now. And why I'm here too.
I'm Stacey Klein. I'm the founder and director of Double Edge 31 years ago. And we were founded in Boston. We moved out here for economic survival and to be able to raise families without being in the trash, basically, if where we were in Boston. And I would like to, first of all, I'm really moved that all of you are here, and I appreciate that a lot, and mostly because everybody's really different than me, and the Double Edge, and that's kind of the idea, I think, of creating work that's yours and sharing with
people who are creating work that's theirs and sharing with communities that are themselves. So I love that. I want to introduce my students who are all over there and taking care of us and also our performance just as a whole, and I'm really happy that they're interested. They should be interested in this conversation, and I hope my main student, my daughter over there, Cariel, I was thinking about her when you were talking. I know your mother.
That's why I did where I can. The daughters are dragging.
And they survive us. Right now, I think I am really working on beauty. What is the nature of beauty? How do we share beauty? What's the power of beauty to transform people, not just in art, but in our relationships? Because for many years, for my whole youth, I was angry, and that's another matter. That had its power, but I've realized that the world is extremely angry and pretty awful, and I'm thinking, what I want to share is what I believe is the antidote to that, that I believe is possible, and that my community has taught me that it's possible to share on that basis.
You want to
introduce yourself? Sure. I'll just briefly say. So I'm Javiera, and I work on a few different projects. One is the Arts of Democracy project, which supports artists and activists working together to do various kinds of social justice organizing. And I'm also collaborating with Marty on Art at Work, and we're piloting a project based on the work she's been doing in Portland in Holyoke, Mass, which is where I live. And I think what brings me to the work is just a profound understanding and recognition that things aren't working the way they are. And after having been an activist and an organizer as a young person in high school and then in college, feeling like there was an emptiness still in that. Like, I really wanted to change things, but I wasn't being fed by the work. And that's what brought me to art making and theater and this place in particular. I spent 4 years here, and the work I did here and the relationships I built here have been feeding me ever since. And I'm still kind of, that still surprises me because it's been a while, but it really was profound. And I think it really taught me the power of art and the power of culture and the power of creative practice and what a resource that is for us. So that is why I'm here.
John, Jennifer, if you guys like to introduce yourself.
I'm Jennifer Johnson. This is John Hateso, my partner and husband. And we run the Charlestown Working Theater in Charlestown, Massachusetts. It's a neighborhood of Boston. We have been working there for 20 of the 40 years that it's been open, but it's a neighborhood that I grew up in and a theater that I grew up in, and in which we are raising a variety of children who are ours or not ours. And we've worked with Double Edge as long as we've run the Charleston Working Theater with them at the same time in Boston, sort of on their way here. So now we have two communities that we work in. We purchased a house here last year. We work here in the summer and other times, and we work in Boston. And the collaboration is gone from being sort of artistic to being familial, to being very intimate in a way that I think a lot of us are speaking to in the room. And that's important to me artistically because our neighborhood of Charleston, where I grew up, is a really sort of tough, skeptical, when I was growing up, very violent neighborhood of Boston. But what has changed Charlestown the most is gentrification. That had the most violent impact on the neighborhood. And I think that part of our job at the theater is welcoming artists from all around the world, and importantly, keeping it as sort of a portal to people's relations with each other and their own imaginations. I had a couple of teenagers write me after a show that they did not like that they saw the theater this summer. And like really intense sort of emails to me about how it was not okay. Oh, Romeo and Juliet. Not in good way. And it was just a really beautiful moment for me because I think that I entered that theater when I was 9 years old and my son is 9 years old, and it became a world for me. And so we want to sort of keep it a world open within this tumultuous luxury condominium world that is sort of becoming Charleston. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay.
That's so typical.
Hi, I'm John. Sorry, emotional. No, it's very, very important. Glad to be here, and I connect with a lot of everyone here. In the way of just sort of the possibilities and imaginations and survival. And I like to think of this sort of place, this sort of context, even to say what Joe was saying about this sort of resourcefulness and reinventing and sort of renewing and resalvaging that we're always constantly doing. I think that's something that I've learned working with Stacy, working here and just in Charlestown and just in through time of just sort of as we just sort of accumulate and take what remains and continue to cobble together our realities. And so I'm very glad to be here and participate.
Great.
Yes.
Great. Thank you, everyone. That was great. There are, as Stacy mentioned, our summer interns are here, our apprentices are here, other ensemble members, Milena and Jeremy and Hannah, we've met, and many others that aren't necessarily in front of us. So I just wanted to acknowledge them. It is a team effort. I want to re-acknowledge the people who might be watching online. I want to encourage you at home. You have operators standing by. Celebrity operators. Yes, oh, right behind Gus here is Ryan Fairley as well, another collaborator whose work you'll see tonight in Shahrazad, the summer spectacle. I'd like to take a quick break so people can get coffee and water and use the bathroom, just a 5-minute break. Afterwards, we'll come back. I want to plant the idea for perhaps it's for tomorrow that we find a way, and Paulie and I started to talk about this, and I didn't ever concretely resolve the question, but find a way to take the conversation tomorrow into some form of a work session. That could, I was thinking, become some form of mapping or some form of organizing. It could be some labbing or prototyping, a couple of things. I don't know. I don't need to know, and maybe later tonight it'll reveal itself, but that part of this will go from this to, this. So let's take 5 minutes now and do what you need and we'll... And afterwards tonight there'll be a gathering all together. There'll be food and some drinks, etc. At lunch also, if you haven't had one already, there'll be a few tours of the farm, but not taking you to any of the performance locations, so nothing is spoiled or ruined. I knew this morning that I had asked some of the right people to be here, because many people who didn't come to the show last night came up to me and said, I can't believe I missed the show with the storm. Like, that's the one I want to go to. Of course, Art and Survival. Holly is, you know, there at the stern of the ship. The rain and the mini tornado. Okay, great. So I want to let people know that this is being not only web streamed, but it's being documented. So this will be archived at New Play TV and the Double Edged website. And thanks again, Vijay. I didn't acknowledge your help in setting all this up. And also, this is coinciding with sort of our first alumni weekend. So a lot of our collaborators and former students and current students are here. One of them is Jeff, who's going to be sort of scribing and taking copious notes. So if there's something that someone says that ends up being of interest to you, it'll be recorded for the most part, as much as possible.
Can I just inappropriately interrupted.
No, no.
But I am so struck by all the cool things that people have said. Like, there's a thousand one-liners I could live by that happened in the first hour. And I have this instinct to get my camera out and document people as they're talking and create some sort of, I mean, I just feel like we should figure out a way, as many ways as possible for you guys, some of the videos, that, like a long video stream is one kind of commitment for some kind of job. So I don't know how you're all doing that part of it, but I keep putting everybody's names down there. They're great one-liners that sound like that.
Yes.
It's like a manifesto or something. Art and Survival, something.
That could be part of, you know, we could break up into some groups tomorrow and sort of, you know, work with some of the stuff that's been said in that way. We have talked to the folks at Animating Democracy and pulling some of these nuggets of wisdom and creating some form of toolkit. So we can definitely put that on the agenda. Also, I think at this stage, now that we're past the sort of niceties of introductions, we should feel free to interrupt. I will say again.
Be nasty.
Be nasty. if it ends up becoming a more lively debate, we'll figure out a way of organizing, you know, something if necessary. But seriously, we aren't having the people aren't being organized the way they're sitting, so that we can. We'll pose questions maybe at the beginning to a few people, but once we're talking, please feel free to interrupt for clarity, to disagree, agree, add something. That'll be good. Okay, so this first sort of entry point, which, you know, I really struggle with the language, but that's fine, is focused on. In thinking about survival, I think of survival and evolution as being either interchangeable or really connected. Thinking about how we evolve artistry. How do we grow it? How do we further the development of aesthetics and artistic practices and methodologies? I wanted to start with a simple question. The people that, although there are many involved in this, the people that sort of brought us the initiating voices are Clyde and Nick, Crystal and Stacy. In thinking about all of your work, which is quite eclectic when put together, there are some very strong aesthetics, there's some strong ideology informing the work, philosophies. I was wondering and thinking about it as a way of introducing your work in this framework, if you might be willing to talk about that ideology and aesthetics and philosophy of your work as a way of connecting it to how it has grown, how you spoke to this end in your introduction. I mean, this question about how you manage these essences, these energies, with your ultimate sustainability.
Well, I'm just trying to start. I'm sorry, I just don't sit up here. So I kind of think of this in the ideas of
what underlies a lot of the work that I do is perception and purpose. And right now, I'm at the kind of intersection of what that means in a very privileged environment. I just said to some of you that I work at Middlebury College, which is a very small liberal arts college in Vermont. And I am what is often talked about as being very candid, which being the only black woman on the faculty of the entire college just kind of means that I'm honest, I think. Or there's something about me that's not normal in terms of what that club of academia means. What I often am struck by is perception. And I've been struck by that since I began dancing, because there's something about my body on stage that evokes different things in people no matter what the dance is about. And in community, that also means that I have a different way of entering community. And it means that my artistic career, as well as my academic career in terms of survival, is always built on how people are perceiving it. There are certain companies that I can't be even eligible to audition for if I'm being realistic with myself as a short African-American muscular woman. Just not gonna get in. And so in academia, that translates into what type of scholarship, or what's valid about the ideas that I know from experience and not necessarily from traditional research. And so in academia, the perception that I am, I use this sometimes to my advantage, always with my students, is that I can always play my black woman card of, well, you can't outdance me, so you're not gonna, what are you gonna challenge me about? You read a book, great. But underlying that is really their perception of how they're buying that. Like, are you really, and then I change it oftentimes, like, did you really buy that? You really think that that's true? You really feel like you can't outdance, like, do you really feel like your ideas are not as valid as mine because of what I look like? And so there's that level of survival and perception for me is a constant shift. My mother's a politician, so it's a constant shift of what you see and how I can use what you see to survive in an environment that may not be conducive to who I am.
And if I can put it into the realm of your artistic work,
yeah.
A friend of mine told me about a performance that you made, a dance piece that is a form of tribute to Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
Can you speak, can you tell us a little bit about that work and how that fits into, tell us what it looks like and feels like and how that connects to the ideology of your work.
Sure. So, for the last 10 years, I've had an all-female company, and you saw my son running around. I often say that having a son shines light on things that you never paid attention to before. And so I have been building my company around a female perspective for a very long time, and I come from a family of African-American men that have been, what I would like to say, trapped in a cycle of failure with no real prowess of their own. And so I often look at my son as the defining factor of the rest of my family lineage and how I can better mold this little person into being, not participating in the perceptions of failure that he's fed from society. And so living in a predominantly white environment, I'm often thinking that if he can understand the privilege of that perception, then he can often understand the power of his own purpose in society. So I was looking for, I got called to work on a piece about Muhammad Ali by a jazz composer named Fred Ho.
Yeah.
You may know. And so it was the kind of first piece that I was commissioned to do where it wasn't my idea. I was just in service of the music. And then that collaboration kind of dissipated. And then I was very interested in the idea of the fight of Muhammad Ali, who I believe had a very spiritual focus and a very kind of divine intention for his life that he had to channel through the perception of other people in a very different way. And I think a lot of men of color have that impetus to do something great, but they have to do it in very circumvented ways. They have to be very good at something that's spectacular for you to listen to what they really think is the truth. And I kind of feel like that's been my career in terms of, you're the little girl that, you're the girl that can dance, great, let me see you dance, and then I'll listen. So it's a thing of like show gives you the credibility to actually be you listen to. So in terms of thinking about Muhammad Ali, I was thinking about what that life looks like, and it's a very opulent thing from the outside. But the inside is about integrity of heart and integrity of purpose. And so the piece is called Opulence of Integrity, because I was trying to look at the idea of how you continue to speak the truth even in a very tumultuous, from a very tumultuous perception of who you are and how all those pieces of self kind of either refract or reflect what you're really trying to do.
Great. It's interesting because Double Edge began as an ensemble of all women in its first few years. And part of its evolution had to do with having men. it's just, I mean, maybe it's a side note, but do you want to speak to that in some way?
Well, there's a very concrete beginning there, which was that I was a PhD student at Tufts, struggling with pretending I was an academic, and I needed to make work. And in that time period at Tufts, like they had barely joined the 20th century, and so we weren't, there were no parts for women, there were no plays by women. I had to fight as an assistant to get for colored girls on the docket in terms of like some kind of woman's performance, and I was very involved in the women's community and making festivals of women's theater when I was there. So this was all really upsetting to me. And there was also no women on the faculty. There were no people of color on the faculty. And basically, there was a bunch of old white men. So that was difficult. And that's why I made work with women. And I also, they hadn't joined the idea that theater actors were creators. So the actors were all sort of pawns to the idea, whether it was a playwright or a director or something like that there. So I wanted to do something with training. So we were 3 years an all-women's company, and then we actually started to get men because we felt we couldn't define ourselves further as women without men. And I think that's true since then about everything about Double Edge. We needed to engage this community because we couldn't define ourselves any longer amongst this community without working directly with the people from the community that weren't us, and so on. So, I mean, I think that's, if you're an outsider, you need to work with the people that are outside of you, the strangers, in order to grow yourself.
I was wondering maybe if Clive, you wouldn't mind speaking a little bit about the sort of the evolution of your work until now and going forward, because it seems like you're also at a moment of transition, not transition, but there's evolution happening, and also there are some very particular aesthetics, and I think the philosophy behind it too.
Yeah, a lot of transition, actually, Matthew. It's pretty tremendous right now, actually. You know, my partner knows because, you know, she's with me every day when I kind of, you know, get home and I scratch my head or pulling hairs out one or the other with the challenges. I think there's some value in the tension that comes out of change. Like, if there is a tension, and when we sat at the table earlier, Ed kind of referenced that, she was like, there's no dissent here, what's going on, right? And made me think about, you know, the moment for us now as an organization and transition and like the tension that's emerging from it, which is, I think, pretty healthy, actually. So I'm optimistic. But in terms of, you know, the work, I think one of the most brilliant things we did, and when I say we, I specifically mean Camilla Forbes, Danny Hock, and myself, sitting around a table when we were talking about this more than 10 years ago, was not to be dogmatic about trying to define the aesthetic, right? Where we weren't gonna be the ones to do that in the form that we were creating, which was the festival. And we were gonna be as open as possible and let the artists coming in kind of shape that, right? And you know, choose their form. So,
when was my background. When was the first festival?
First festival was in 2000. And, you know, Danny knew he wanted to produce two artists, solo artists, two women, Liza Colon Zayas and Sarah Jones. You know, Liza's piece was directed by Stephen Andy Girgis. Stephen was just beginning to write plays, kind of, like he was, you know, in his own survival mode at that particular moment. Gloria Feliciano was really nurturing Sarah. Sarah was kind of already doing her thing. And we just had a couple of weeks where we were dark in the theater. This is the creation story, and we just needed to fill it with something, you know? And Issa Davis wrote an article in the Source magazine, which is a hip-hop magazine. It came out in 1999 or 2000, and it featured everybody we ended up calling to be in the festival. And it was talking about a generation of artists who were self-identified as hip-hop, who were, you know, creating theater, right? And some of it was variations on Shakespeare, some of it was original work, some of it was, you know, and we just kind of called everybody up and we created a place and named it something, right? So the new name even, naming it, you know, kind of continuing that from an institutional perspective, you know, was a big deal. And we've been talking about it since 2008, you know, 2007, in terms of what a new name would look like, you know, for the organization as we were growing, you know, institutionally. But with respect to the work and kind of where I am, you know, what's shaping my thinking about it, because, you know, we're all making. Camilla directs, you know, Danny continues to write. You know, I'm finding my way into, you know, either, you know, picking pieces and directing and dramaturging work is, you know, kind of, you know, what's the best way with respect to form to tell this story, right? And then to kind of look at our community and see who are the exemplars of that form and look to bring them in to a process where, you know, things like trust aren't easy to come by, right? We're asking folks, so there's individual transformation too, I think, in terms of folks who don't necessarily, folks who aren't necessarily accustomed to kind of working in a particular way. Because I think the culture, hip-hop culture specifically for me, it saved me, it's inspired me, but you know, it's wide and deep and complicated, you know? And I've always leaned towards the most positive aspects of that that are about transformation, that are about change, that are about the positives that I've witnessed and experienced in my community and in myself, right? So it's always started with me in terms of how can I do something, right? To move the needle and change, because I survived, you know? And I'm sustaining, right? There's, you know, we use this term, we're gonna build, right? You have to build in the cycle, let's, instead of meeting, we're gonna build, let's build, right? So I'm all for survival, but I'm more for building.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, to me that's another way of saying that, sustainability.
Yeah.
Right? And that's easier said than done. Right? So I'm interested in what you guys have created. You know, I have an AS220 shirt on right now, you know, and I'm really interested in what they did up there. I'm interested in, you know, I appreciate what you've been able to build here in terms of Double Edge. And that kind of building, you know, I'm still trying to find where to point within my own community of peers, because there's a lot of individual arts and artists making work, but in terms of sustainability and infrastructure where you can come in, because it's always going to be there, and you're going to contribute to it, and you're going to help that next floor, I don't quite know where that is,
right.
You know? In the United States.
That's a great, I think, segue to you, Nick, in a way, because maybe you can speak about Mondo Bizarro through your relationship to New Orleans, where I think, obviously, you know, pre, during, and post-Katrina, there's a very particular relationship to infrastructure and resources. Mm-hmm. How has that shaped the way you make work? How has that shaped the way you've kept an ensemble and evolved through the work?
We were about a year and a half into having a company when Katrina happened. So obviously the whole reason that we do the work we do right now, I think, is in response to or in collaboration with what that storm was. And I think the first thing, the memory I have is there's a woman named Carol B. Bell. She runs the Ashe Culture Art Center. And she invited us, she said, if you're in town, we made fake press passes and snuck back into the city. And we had all these grandiose ideas about what we were going to do. So we set up a wireless router in our apartment and we made a little office. But Carol said, no, come to the theater. And I was like, oh, good, she wants to do some theater work. And when I walked in the theater, just the whole stage was filled with cleaning supplies. And she was like, take those cleaning supplies and bring them to here. And then we went back to the theater and she said, now go get somebody's cat out of their house over here. And the process of doing that made us sort of suspend the artistic endeavors we had at the time and think about really deeply what we wanted to do in the work. And the thing that came to us was that I think it's obvious to everybody, but it wasn't to me at the time, that every space is not a place. You know, that we had been working in spaces, some of which weren't places. Mm-hmm. And that what we really wanted to do was work in places that were imbued with a certain history and a story. And we wanted to listen deeply in those places, which sort of led us to doing our work in a site-responsive manner and taking our work out to the streets and to abandoned golf courses and abandoned schools. And a lot of people in New Orleans were doing this at the time because there weren't actual physical spaces you can be in many instances. But also, we just started to find that the work was a lot more alive, and the conversation, the dialogue about the work was a lot more alive in those places. Of course, many people who had been doing this for a couple hundred years in New Orleans were like, well, thanks for catching on. like the social aid and pleasure clubs in New Orleans, who were formed to take care of their sick and to bury their dead, and who hold the tradition of a jazz funeral procession or a second line, where they use the streets as the democratized space to share their work. And they do it at a really high level. So that just led us down a path of, I heard somebody say that fix. Every new space becomes a little bit of that fix. And then it started intersecting our work with people who thought differently than us, and city officials and government officials and folks in neighborhoods and people who just kept challenging the assumptions that we made when we tried to make a piece of art. And like Stacy pointed out, that we just ran into difference and it was hard, and then we messed up a lot and we aggravated people and we didn't do things right. And that has sort of led us to the project we're working on now, this project Cry You One, which is part of an evolution of work that's looking at coastal land loss in South Louisiana. And just one little anecdote about that, which is about the best one about survival recently. Cry You One's a 2-mile procession in a wetlands 11 miles out of New Orleans that's disappearing really rapidly. And we're taking the audience on a really large journey. But to get on a levee in Louisiana, you have to get permission from the Army Corps of Engineers and the federal government. And so we had to bring this guy to come see our work in process showing of our piece. So we invited him, and he's there with all the local stakeholders. And he's got a little dip in his mouth, and he's got sunglasses on. He's just watching the whole thing, and I'm thinking, oh, God, he hates it. And I went up to him after, and he said, I've never seen a live performance in my entire life. I was like, I've never watched theater. And he said, And I thought you guys wanted to do Phantom of the Opera on the levee. And then he like stepped back and he like spit in his cup and he's like, but I tell you, this audience participation shit is blowing my mind. And then he went on to say, he got real deep in it and he said, so what do you guys want to do? You want to get rid of the levees in Louisiana? Like, I'm hearing what you're saying in your piece. And he's like, I don't like this job. He's like, but if I don't protect this levee system, then this parish can't get flood insurance. So let's talk about it. And then we engage this dialogue that we've been in ever since. And not only has he come on to be like a production manager with his tractors and his four-wheel drives and his levee system, you know, we start asking, what can we do for you? And so he used to be like, why do y'all want to run and play instruments on the levee at 6:30 a.m., you know? And now what we do is we tell him where the boars rutted up the levee or this and that. And so like, I think the reason we connected so fast is because his job is just about survival, which is, if I don't protect this levee, this community is gonna flood, right? And we don't agree at all politically about how that happened or whatever, but him and every other landowner, every other person, since the moment that the thing about survival is the preservation of, or the protection of, or the attempt to illuminate what we can do to help this land, which is gonna go away, like just for the moment, I don't think it's gonna even, we're gonna be able to save anything. But for the moment, everyone can come to a sort of agreement that where we stand on common ground and we're moving from there. And a lot of really awesome things are happening that sort of illuminate our work, I feel like, more than a lot of times when we're in dialogue or in exchange with other theater companies or other artistic visions and are asking us to push ourselves aesthetically. And to reimagine our training and to do a lot of things that I sometimes don't get from the art world or the artistic environment, you know. So
I'm glad that you mentioned training too. But we'll come back to that later and how that process relates to the concrete practicalities of survival. But as Anne and Stacey, you both have multi-decade-long ensembles.
You mean we're old.
I'm
shocked every time I look in the mirror. I was like, who is that person?
And I wanted to ask you both, and this is really, I'd like to extend this question out. So you have a...
If anyone else is old.
If you want to know. I'm not going to respond to any of this stuff. A moment in the evolution of your work where there was, like, someone else mentioned, or referred maybe to Aaron to some Darwinian metaphor, maybe it wasn't here, about adaptability, maybe it was, I don't know, someone over here. So in thinking about adaptability, that usually comes at a moment of either near death or near extinction or some very intense adversities. Can, in whichever order, is there a moment in the history where that your company's either almost folded or you and your work almost folded or where there's some, not fold, but some moment that was a near death or near extinction that led to some evolutionary change?
You know, I have to say, we're on that state every day. We're seriously. It's always about the fall. And I've come to actually enjoy that. In other words, I at some point got the attitude, like, if it falls apart, it's okay. And because I have that attitude, nobody will let it fall apart. I don't know why. Like, if I were desperate to hold together, maybe everybody else would be desperate, too. But, you know, I want to share something tangential a little bit. But have you guys seen the new documentary on Ai Weiwei?
Yeah.
Amazing, right? Ai Weiwei, this extraordinary political activist / artist, you don't know which one worked first. And in the beginning of the film, it's an amazing film, and you can't miss it, it's on Netflix now. He says that he doesn't actually initiate anything. He said, I just react. Which I found extraordinary because his work is so aggressive, you know, and he's been in prison for 5 months at a time because of his activism. But then he said, I have a couple of Chinese things to say, him being one of them. He says, well, what I do is I just push back a little bit. And if I push back, something always happens. And I find that extraordinary, like that way of thinking. In other words,
you don't go in to carve something out, but you just start to respond to what's there, and that's going to be more authentic and more actual and deeper and more related to the world than if you actually have your own agenda of what you want to actually make happen. And the Maya said I'm going to be Chinese. I had a Tai Chi a master once. He used to say all the time, his English was really bad. He said, to do the not to do. That was his central message. To do the not to do. It's not don't do. It's to do the not to do. He went on. He actually said, if you're depressed, what you do is to do the not to do, do the never mind, do the good job, 2 weeks, you'll be OK. Anyway, but to do the not to do. Last night, since she's on the board of Arena Stage, something that happened to Molly Smith years ago when I was, for 1 year, the artistic director of Trinity right before I was fired a year later on the board. And I was having a really hard time with the board and the company and the community. And I had invited Molly to come and direct there. She did Genoso play, the Steinberg Night. And she knew I was in trouble at some point. And if you know Molly, who's the artistic director of Arena Stage, she is, and she comes, you know, comes from Alaska. She's a formidable mountain woman, or river woman or something. Anyway, she said, she
loves to come face to face with a bear.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And so she saw that I was in trouble, and she took me aside, and she said, you know, when you kayak, and you get to the really bad part of the water, the explosive part, your whole instinct is to turn, is to lean away from it. Your only chance for survival is to lean into it. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about that in relation to what you said, Nick, about what happened with Katrina. You said, in a sense, you leaned into it. You said, this is going to transform it, and it changed everything, right? So it's not to say I'm going to fight it, you know, to do the not to do. It's not to say I'm going to overwhelm it or I'm going to win, but to lean into the thing and to allow that transformation, to trust that you're a big enough person and that you stand, you have a strong core, which you can't exist in this world without a strong core, and yet you can enter the current and let it transform you, which means you're really strong if you can let something transform you. And I think also what Stacey and Carlos and Matthew and everybody have done here is amazing. And I was just saying to Stacey, I've come here over the number of years, and to see the transformation here and see the community involved, and something's really happening. And I think that kind of leaning into what's already there is in a sense the key. You know, I think Morgan, you were saying earlier about using, what is it, the stone soup. You know, that you use what's already there, that we have the tools we need. Mm-hmm. And rather than complaining about how we don't, is it actually to use actually what's there, and those tools will bring you to the next tool, you know, what that is. The end.
I kind of want to join what you said, Clyde and Nick. I think the major cities need people who are trying to create community there or work, need to go out to other places like here or many, many places, I think, what Nick said, but lots and lots of work and different ideas are happening all over the place. And in the city, there seems to be this idea that it has to be this way or one way or something, what it is, or it can't be there. Like, people can't do local food in the city. Why not? I mean, you can do it any place. Or all of these survival things that it took us, of course, leaving the city to find out and to be really taught in many hard ways, like you were saying. I mean, we made so many mistakes. We were so wrong for so many years. And we were really taught, our children were, you know, victims of our stupidity.
and then kind of led us to open our eyes to there's people here and they can teach, even though we might know something about something. They know something about something. So that exchange together is what I think teaches one. We all need to survive, not just artists. All people need to survive. We need to do our part. We can lead some things. Other people need to do their part. The food makers need to do their part. So we, together, we find little constellations that will create things. It takes, I mean, for us, it's taken 19 years we've been in Ashfield. And the last 3 years, I think, we've actually been in Ashfield. And made a community. So it isn't something, even if we had been brilliant and not like thought that we could come here and just do whatever we wanted or be accepted here. I mean, there's a lot of issues about being accepted here that weren't all our problem. I mean, the community has its own problems, as everybody does. In accepting different kinds of people. So, but it still takes time because anything that's real takes time. I mean, it takes time to grow food and it takes time to grow culture and it takes time to be part of something and make a performance or whatever you're doing. So we can't go someplace and expect to make something important or real or of value in a year or whatever. So we have to slowly accept that our pace might not be and do little things that are important along the way.
I'd like to come back maybe a little bit later to some moment of some evolutionary moment for people where adaptability kicked in, where that leaning into the disaster or adversity led to some unexpected form of adaptation. You were talking about community, Stacy, and Mark, I'm wondering if you wouldn't mind sharing a little bit about how you see theater artists or ensembles encountering a new mutuality with community that unearths resources, artistic and otherwise.
I was thinking about just the notion of survival and how it doesn't actually take much to subsist. Water, some food, but I think the other part is that other human beings or companionship feels like vital to subsistence,
right,
to survival, and so as we think about like this idea of mutuality and just kind of the ensemble form, that it at its essence it kind of is crafted around that companionship. Or I'm making this up as I go on, so forgive me for not having all the words, but that's companion. It's more than that. But it's that idea of mutuality. And we were kind of just, they had this event in Hawaii. And I think what I walked away with was this, the mutuality part, that we are all interconnected. The I am the you and you are the me part of how work happens, how we survive. And I think that the longevity of ensembles, who was it, Richard, who said collaboration is really hard. Like there's, you know, you don't do it because it's easy. You don't do it because it's like, why not? You know, because that there's it. You need it to survive. Because it's there's some survivalist part of it. Both kind of, I think, in a very real, like, it's too hard to do by yourself. You know, that you need the others to make it happen. But also the more spiritual human part of it. And so I think that aspect of kind of the field about this kind of work, I think is very central to why it's not only surviving, but now we're kind of going beyond subsistence and survival to thriving. And so there's something around, you know, there's something there, and now that we're kind of like part of getting to that thriving part is the cross pollination part, is you know, just what Anne was talking about now going outside of ourselves to work with others, like that seems like an ecology that there seems to be something really that's telling us something. I don't know exactly what it is, but I will kind of like point us to that as maybe something we want to investigate. Yeah, I don't know if I answered your question.
No, that's great. Yeah, I mean, I think we're sort of wandering around the subject right now. I'm really curious. I haven't been able to really put my finger on this yet, but I think there's a real relationship between our relationship to resources and to the work that comes out of it. At times at Double Edge, we've been making work and needing to, you know, use whatever is at our disposal. So in some ways, the aesthetics of the work becomes, in some ways, about reinvention. Because there isn't the production budget of, you know, whatever, something that's well endowed. And I feel that different companies and organizations and artists have a particular relationship to resources, and then that informs their aesthetics and their work in certain ways. Can anyone speak to that specifically, maybe in terms of their work or a specific moment in their work or production, or even more generally, how that's evolved in their work?
Well, I think that we have used, we started this land-based project, which some of you saw last night, which is the summer spectacle, because we needed to use the land as a resource rather than build a set or have any materials, because we didn't have any money for that 12 years ago. So we basically went outside, which was free, more or less, and used the water and used all of these things. And I think today it's grown into, we are trying to use all resources of this area or this region, like sheep's wool or, you know, stones, stuff like that, and that in the end costs, of course, a lot of money, but still, it started out as a different thing, and I think that taught us about, you know, what is it to work on the land, to work with natural resources, to work with people who kind of plow those things, or sow those things, or make those things. And I think that's cool. And we've tried to also take that into our indoor performances now, where we're trying to sculpt based on these same type of resources. And I really like that.
And whatever you do with the resources, you have to go through a process of them. Like if you have a really big budget and you don't go through the process of transforming what you choose, then it has no substance. I'll give you an example. When I was a young director, I couldn't get arrested for years. Yeah, I always wanted to work in a theater, but I couldn't get a theater, so I did what was didn't have the next site specific or immersive in those things. Remember, we went to a lot of them, on rooftops, or shops, or whatever it was called, then they called it downtown. Anyway. And so we would always have these brainstorming sessions first with the actors, like what or whoever was working on it, like what do you imagine? Oh, 15 motorcycles. Oh, 15 motorcycles, right? It would turn into a bicycle, right? You know what I mean? Like you go through this process and you don't have the money for 15 motorcycles. Anyway, long story short, I finally got hired in Berlin, in not that trip, Morgan. Earlier, like in 1981, to direct a show with the graduating students, you know, and you get to the essence. So the worst thing, in a sense, you can do, it's not a matter of your budget, it's your process. And as you say, it's gotten more expensive now, right? You're using the actual, well, that's not really the point. The point is how you got to that place. And that's what an audience ultimately feels is your process. It's not your ideas, but your process with whatever stupid ideas you start with.
Great.
We just this past week, we had an expected source of income fall through for some of our arts education program, you know, that we're introducing into the space. And we sat down with the teaching artist that we're working with, who's amazing artist in her own right, and that's always important to us in terms of the artists that we work with, that they're practitioners first, you know, before they're, you know, doing anything else, that they're actually active in their own process. And we were talking about, well, you know, do we have to modify? Do we want to scale up from 6 weeks to 9 weeks? You know, what kind of materials are we going to purchase? And do we do this other track, which was for middle school students, 10 to 13? A lot, and that's the primary population in the block. We got to look shorties on the block. We run by, knock on the door, to step in when there's openings, and we want to do something immediately for them. And, you know, what just kind of came out of that conversation was brilliant, right? Because all of a sudden it wasn't, oh, we're going to buy X, Y, and Z in terms of materials. It was, well, you know, I have access to, you know, some of Romare Breathing's work through an individual collector. We can take this collage-based, you know, practice and bring it into the community with these young people. And we could just take whatever's around us so that, you know, they can start identifying what community means to them in visual expression, right? And it riffs off of a project that we're going to do, you know, in the beginning of October with Michael and Rachel in terms of their housing and human rights work. So that conversation now, so that just kind of happened this week, but that was an example of like money, no money, but we're still making, right? We're still going to make this thing happen, and it's going to be brilliant. It's going to be great because we're doing it with community, you know? So that's like a concrete. And that's us following the artist. Like if we weren't at the table with that particular person, you know, where if it was just about money, you know, money isn't creativity, right? Money is just a means to an end. That's, you know, but the end, you know, the end is in part the journey, you know, the process.
I'm just gonna say that one of the resources that we found, or I found most valuable for me in building my company and community engagement project for the people that were involved, and then the idea of evolution in using those people in a reciprocal manner has always allowed the work to continue whether I'm participating or not. And so with my company InSphere, what we did is we created an artist executive structure. So the people you saw on stage were the same people who were doing the books, and they were getting trained by either myself with my undergraduate little business degree, or you know, other people who came in to volunteer. And so then those women were on stage, and their investment in the work was much different because it wasn't, and my name wasn't on it. Most dance companies are known for the choreographer, and then that's it. And so their work was also, they were also the repertory choreographers for the company. So that kind of reciprocal investment then allowed them to continue working and deepen their investment in the work and allowed for me to step away, and then three other companies were born out of In Spirit, and the community engagement project has been taken over by, you know, just other people who just want to do their own thing. So it's a different kind of resource in using what you have there at the moment in the people and kind of asking what's the best thing you can bring to the table.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. Might not be very coherent, but I think something that art, and especially artists, have a great relationship is with words. And I was thinking a lot as we were going through the introductions and continuing to speak about perception and art and how we put words to perception and put words to our art and how that changes our continuity and our survival. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if someone could speak to that a little.
I think about that all the time. I don't want to overwhelm the conversation. I think it's the biggest issue. I believe in words so deeply, and I think we use all the wrong words. Mm-hmm. And this is not my original thought. I remember it was started by Jan Whitehead, I'm sure you know, who wrote an article that was very incendiary about 15 years ago in American Theater. And she was talking about the words we use to describe who we are. And she said, why do we call ourselves non-profit? That's like when somebody would say, hi, I'm non. Or try this one on. Unearned income. Hello, that's the most earned income you'll ever get in your life.
Yeah.
You know, and then I started thinking about rehearsal processes.
Yes.
And I thought, oh, the word, and we've had this conversation, and we have, I'm not going to go there, but the word want is killing the rehearsal process. Like, if a director's always is saying, okay, now I want you to walk downstage, or the actor says, what do you want me to do? Or, is this what you want? It's like, what did I hear that? As a director, if an actor says, is this what you want? It's like, well, what I want is a little bit obscene and has nothing to do with the play. the word want in rehearsal sets up a sort of parent-child relationship, you know, which is not something I'm very interested in a rehearsal. Then I also think about like the way we name our companies. And I have a problem with my own company name. It's not a very good name. We all complain about that. But, you know, I think if a lot of people name their companies like On a String or It's Not Important. Right? It's like, I'm not dangerous.
Underfoot dance.
Like, I know nothing about the following company. I know they were a bunch of kids who came out of Skidmore and live in Brooklyn and have a space. But they call themselves the National Theater of the United States of America.
Yeah.
It's like, great! I think that's fantastic! I just think the words are everything. And they send out a message before you arrive, and then you have to live up to what you describe. So I think that's the key. And then I just thought, just one more thing about language, because this the word survival, and I'm really glad you chose survival, but I wanted to share something also not original. It comes from a book I read years ago that when it originally came out, I can't remember who wrote it, it was called The Gift or the Erotic Life of Property, but then it's been re-put out again, and they didn't use the erotic where he said that we function out of two possible impulses. Mm-hmm. We function out of the survival impulse and the gift-giving impulse. Mm-hmm. And that they are completely, completely different. So for example, if I'm working with a producer, the gift-giving impulse is very particular, and it doesn't have to do with putting a roof over my head or paying my company or anything like that. And the example I share with you, because it's the most obvious one, is like a surprise birthday party where you say, okay. This is the way it's going to go. We're going to turn the lights out. We're going to get behind the couch. When she comes in, count three beats, and then everybody leap up and say, surprise! Now, where does that information come from? Like, where does the information, wait, three beats, or, you know? But that's what doing a play is, right? It's like, three beats, and then the lights come down. And then when a producer comes in and says, you know, you're putting the intermission too late. And I'm going, no, it's where the panic attack, and then the audience. I'm functioning out of the ticketing, and the producer's functioning out of the, you know, tickets, time, stuff like that. Now, but what I think this is important is that both of those are important. Like, you need the survival instinct, and you need the gift giving, but you get into trouble if you merge them. If you confuse which one's coming from where. Mm-hmm. And so in a sense, a company has people who are supposedly the artists and then the administration. Not true, right? Crystal, I think that's so great that you put people right together. But you function in a certain way. The office is working for survival, and in the rehearsal room, you're working for the gift. They have to support each other, but there's artists in the office as well. What they're doing is a kind of art form, you know? But then, just to take one more step, and then I'll shut up, this is every human being has, we have to produce ourselves, right? How do we move through life? Is this moment, am I functioning out of survival, or is this the gift moment? But the minute you confuse them, or you think, I'm going to make a decision for survival, but it just for here, but it really needs to be made from the gift giving, you get into super trouble. And I think a lot of institutional leaders have died, are dead, are carcasses, because they have really confused those issues, and they're run by the marketing departments. But there can
be simultaneity without confusion.
There has to be.
There is also, this is all true, and then there is the macro context where we are placed, all of us. And I think in that, you know, I go back to your words and about the system of lies. So the distortion of the words, like the distortion of the meanings, like we are driven, I am driven, to look into the money when the money is not the value. So I'm concerned about that. You know, this I'm trained by the capitalist lie to look into the money, thinking, oh, this is a lot of money. In reality, what's more important, what Clyde was saying, or Crystal was saying, is how do I work with these people? This is, how do I relate to the resource? So all this confusion, the same as the confusion with violence, how do we handle violence? It's not that we're not handling violence. We are being submitted to violence every day, and we're responding to violence, but we also have a language that is being given to us in many different dosages and in many different media. And that's how we begin, or I think about myself, that's when I begin to lose the relationship with the word, to lose the relationship, and to confuse the giving impulse and the survival impulse. Although, I think I'm pretty clear, I survive a lot, but still, I need to remind myself, you know, I'm gonna be cooked. These guys are out to get me, and I'm letting myself go into there. So I think that's the context here. I think we need to take a look at that. Where are we? Like, you know, I made a conscious decision to come to the U.S. Everybody said, "Oh, from Argentina, go to Europe. Go to Europe. It's the world of culture." I said, "No, I'm gonna go to the bowels of the beast because we're losing this." You know, and that's, Muhammad Ali was a great teacher for all of us down south. Like, he was the one that said, this is the way to go forward. And, you know, we follow a lot of people like that. Now, the context is super important. I mean, we need to remember, I need to remember that I'm always thinking in response of something that is larger than me and that is stimulating me all the time to go into a certain direction. So use this, we're talking about resources. Look at this room. Mm-hmm. It's fabulous, but it's so hard to go to his place or to meet Aaron. And I've been reading about him, but well, here I am. Nice to meet you, or Michael. You know what I mean? So the resources are there, but I'm not daring to go there. I'm too confused, too overwhelmed, you know, flustered. And I don't get them.
So one question.
You're also smart, and you have to use your smarts. I think everybody has to be really smart in this world. Like,
yeah.
Really, really think a lot.
So again, you've been one of the few people, I mean, I've struggled with this, because this whole question of language is one which we've kind of ceded to other people to take and tell our stories, you know. So, and I feel like you've been one of the few artists in the field who actually value. I mean, that you made a project of essays, you know. But when we started HowlRound, the reason we started was because the artists weren't saying anything. They weren't writing it down. They were saying tons of things in the work itself, but they weren't taking an opportunity to own the language. And this has been a grave concern, and I think the carcasses of which you speak are carcasses that have owned the language for at least since 1980, around, you know, what it is to make theater and what communities want. And I think we're at a point of enormous opportunity for reinvention.
But you're doing it. I mean, every morning, the first thing I get in my email box is a HowlRound email. And I sort of say, do I want to read it? You know,
yeah.
Usually on the toilet.
I want to say something about language, because I think that's something that really touched me at the Network of Ensemble Theaters gathering in Honolulu, was the importance of having a language. You know, like, I think that part of our confusion and part of the problem that we don't have the right words is that we're dealing in a language that is designed to enslave, is designed to entrap. Right. It's a legal language. It's a language in which words have multiple meanings, so you never know what a person is actually saying. And what was beautiful about, you know, listening to Vicky Takamini and the Native Hawaiians and the command over their language and what each word means, and that the mountain in this part of the island has a very different word for it than the mountains on the other side of the island, because the winds are different and because the winds have a different name. So you never confuse. The word means exactly what the word means. And that's part of the dismantling of the social function, is that we are dealing in a language that has multiple meanings. And so whenever you're speaking, a person has to understand your value system. They have to understand your context. They have to understand your history to understand what it is that you're saying. Because you can use the exact same words to mean something completely different. And so I think that's a large part of the challenge, because we don't have a language that we come from. We're in a bastardized language, you know, and the language itself is intended to create confusion. And so how do we regain back what it means to have a language that represents our values and speaks from where we are, versus trying to always adopt whatever the going language is. I mean, right now, we work in a place in which funders and philanthropists and government sectors are creating the language. We adopt it because that's part of the survival. You know, you got to have the language in order to get the resources. So if you can't speak this language, then you don't have access to these spaces. It's part of like the whole conversation we're having about cross-cultural, cross-sector work. And I'm like, well, that's not our language. Somebody invented that language and put it on us. And it's used to create a barrier for access. And so if you don't know the language, then you can't speak the language, and you can't get into the secret door that has all the money, you know? And so it becomes that place in which we find ourselves really struggling and always behind the eight ball, even though the language is being used to describe something that we have been doing in our communities for decades. And so they take and look at the practice, and then they create a name for it. And then, you know, because you're not the one who creates the name, you don't know, oh, that's what we're doing? Cross-sector work now? But it's the same work we've been doing for decades. And so we have to kind of resist the shift to just, you know, fall under whatever name it's called at the moment, because that name will change, you know, and the work doesn't change.
Yeah, that would be, I'd love to put that on some list of how-tos. Like, is that some type of a change we could affect strategically or tactically, whichever?
I
know that you were asking to say something.
Yeah, we talk about language all the time, and I think in Native communities, what happens is language is such a thing that we are always holding on to, part of cultural survival. And I think the big part of how, with our theater company, is why it has survived so long, is because we've held on to our language. We have really held on to our language. And we really held on to, okay, well, we've seen so much taken away because of boarding school systems, oppression, whatever. But the point is we're going into this environment, and you see this we're having the youth own this language. And saying, you know, this is the way you say it, but this is the way we say it, because we come from a traditional method. And to take that traditional knowledge and saying it's just as important. And yes, that is where the resource is from. But I think part of the biggest work is looking at the process. And what you're saying, Nick, is to bring a producer in, and what Anne was saying, what happens is they see a piece that you're doing. And for example, we did Ready Mother, which was based on Mother Courage. And that was a 7-year process. That was a 7-year process because the grain was my mother doing Mother Courage. And she had she wanted to do Brecht differently. And they said you couldn't do that. So going in there and bringing me on and going into, and then it turned into a totally different piece on telling war stories. And taking war stories and weaving them and putting into a one-person show. And then it finally going into something, a total different element. So taking our own language and empowering it. And you see this all the time, because what happens is someone will come in and they have a different way of working, but they want to work with you, they want to work with you, they want to work with you. You go in and then they say, well, you know, you really don't have an arc. And it drives people who work in our process really crazy. It makes us nuts. It makes my mother nuts. You know, you have to hold somebody back. You know, or say, well, I don't understand how that's not funny. So, you know, and that's not, those are more fighting words. So taking, and you find out that it presses your buttons because this is the person with resource. And how do you explain this person to resource? This is a traditional method. This is the way, this is an arc. Can't we not call it an, I mean, I've had like meetings upon meetings is dragging somebody out from a rehearsal so my family didn't kill them, and dragging them out and saying, look, do you have another word for arc? Can we say this part? Can we say this does, you know, can we work on that language? And, you know, and after, and it's draining because this is the resource, right? And then you find the same thing happening with the, with funding too. You know, you have that resource, and how you explained it in, grant speak, right? How does that translate? Right. And then so you wind up trying to really, you wind up educating, and that's a draining process, yep. You know.
Glad you're the one who says it.
Well, just made me think about that in itself as the power of translation as a survival tactic, like knowing when you have to kind of switch something up, because it necessitates, that moment necessitates, you know, you using or adopting specific language, and or vice versa, kind of like, you know. But I just wanted to say, you know, what we started to refer to the organization as is for mission, not, you know, not for profit, right? Mm-hmm. So we're for mission, right? Some people are for profit, we're for mission, right? And there's power to that, you know, when you really kind of institute that across,
yep.
You know, who's working on what they're doing.
Right. That's the problem here with the words pro-life, right?
Right. Yeah.
It's too
really
damn good.
Choice. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, not to get into that, but, you know, we're all of us here, at some point, have probably used the word entitlement to talk about basic human rights, you know, and our responsibility to our fellow citizens.
Yeah.
We've all used that word, entitlements. That's crazy to me.
Yeah. I want to come back to what you were saying. Oh, Susan, you wanted to say something. Sorry.
I did, and it goes back to the survival and the gift-giving, and which I think very powerful descriptions. I do a lot of work with nonprofits and arts organizations. And one of my observations, and it's over and over again, has to do with boards and board leadership. And I'm so struck by how many organizations that are struggling really don't have the right boards. They're not the boards that are equal to their mission. They're not the boards that are equal to the artistic aspirations. They're not the boards that are necessarily going to make sure that all employees have health insurance or money for retirement. For me, that's basic survival. It's a right. But I don't think it's at the sacrifice of what's at the heart and soul of the artistic vision of an organization. It's another kind of community building. It's finding the right community members to work with. And the job of an artist is to make art. And so why can't there be other people to do the other things? And it's not always easy, but it's, again, finding those relationships that you have to find within the community of Ashfield. There are people out there who are mad about theater or mad about dance. They're not dancers, and they're not actors, and they're not directors. They want to be part of that life, and they want that life in their communities because that's what makes the community vital. So I just like to put that out there. And that is, for me, it's half survival and it's half gift giving. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it's 60-40. But I think you have to have both.
Mm-hmm. You're hired on all of our boards. You're hired on all of our boards.
Oh, yeah.
I might have forgotten what I wanted to say.
You want me to move on?
Yeah.
This is a, I'll put this out there, I don't know if I can put this all together, but, so with Anne, you were talking about the confusion between, let's say, the market and the gift economies, right, or the gift realms, and the question of language becomes a place for those two, where there's confusion created, I think. And where these realms of work meet. Poetry is the short circuiting of language, which is to bring it back to the ownership, the power of its original intent, let's say, as a gift from another place. So we are, at the one hand, sort of born into some language that doesn't serve us, but at the same time, before all that, there is an inherent power of language which illuminates beyond our what we already know. So our work, in a way, requires us, the artistic work requires some sort of dance with the unknown that enables us to find the metaphor or find the poetry, which short circuits the language again. Mm-hmm. That is a path towards artistic autonomy. Now, that autonomy, which let's call it, that research, let's call it, I can't remember which, if it was Carlos or you, Stacy, we will call the capital W work. So, for Quixote, the capital W work is going down into the caves of Montesinos to speak with that source, right, that unknown. And then the little W work is, let's say, the work of Sancho Panza, which would be holding the rope, or having a rope, mm-hmm. for that matter. There are resources at hand that I think many people in this room, at least, if not all, have encountered that connect the little W work to the big W work in a way that's harmonious, let's say, not dissonant or creating confusion. I think those resources are not the resource, they include the resources of the market, but they also, they're resources that live more strongly in the gift. Mm-hmm. What are those resources? What do you tell a young emerging artist that's like, how do you how do you have training in your life and also have food? If training is the descent into the caves of Montesinos, let's call it training, but we all know what that means, right? If training is that realm where you're learning to learn anew and you're encountering the unknown, what are the resources? I would say those resources, for me, those resources are a group. I can't do it alone. I think courage, which maybe comes from the group. Obviously creativity, but I mean, what are the resources, maybe even the more concrete ones? How have people approached the marriage of capital W and little W work? I do think that relates to language. I do think that work ends up coming back and exploding language as it explodes forms. I've seen in looking and talking to the people who have been sort of the minor focus today, that there is an explosion of form in all of the work that you do.
Matthew, I just say that we were ridiculed, maybe told that that's the wrong thing to do over and over again, but we had a philosophy from the beginning of our company that free is a radical act, and that if we had or ever run into resources, that it doesn't matter how far we grow as a company, in the context of our community, if we don't share the resources that we have within our community, that it won't matter what we are or what we ever become or what we accomplish. And we try to, and that grew out of the work of John O'Neill in the Free Southern Theater, by the Free Southern Theater, and his mentorship, and all of the people around us who are looking at us and saying, grow as you may and succeed as you may, but just remember, you're only as big as the next person around you. And I feel like that's one thing that I think about often, is how do we share the resources that we have in the most radical ways? Because even in a little bitty community like New Orleans, I find ourselves more and more infighting, you know, in a very tiny community around a very limited pool of resources. So one
that principle led to you having more of the conditions to do your artistic work?
Absolutely, because it led to us to stop thinking about, for example, getting a space on our own. Right? So now we collectively run a space, which, might I say, is a nightmare. But that nightmare has us on a floor for the first time in 10 years that we can go to every day. You know, it's like that we never had that a year ago. So like we can practice in a different way. So I feel like it's the first instinct to all of these things everybody's been saying about individualism and language and capitalist based sort of models was to try to seek on our own, you know, instead of seeking together. And every time, I don't feel like this field supports dynamic leaders, individuals. This field supports those people. It does not support collective action, because that impetus is dangerous for the striped structures that support our work. And so where we can, when we can succeed at doing that, it hasn't led to all the success in the world, but it's led to some fire, and it's led to a feeling of aliveness that's good, you know.
I would like to say that I think that has changed.
Yeah.
Or at least it started to change, because when I was in Boston and I tried to make a theater meeting of all the theaters in Massachusetts, and it was so aggressive and bitter, and people were so competitive and mean. I met Jennifer and John at that meeting. It was a long time ago. And they're still here. But today, like, you can, in this room, for instance, there's a lot of people, or really different types of people that would have 10 years ago been competitive or aggressive or not listening to each other. And I feel like there's a whole shift, maybe because of how awful the world is, that there's a lot of collective activity. There is in communities, there is in theater, there's a lot of collaboration that there didn't used to be. I think jealousies have turned into actually trying to find different ways
to me, there's a lot of hope in very small numbers, but it's always been small numbers of people that are actually working.
You know, this is really, the Jay should talk about this more, but this question of the W, the big W, the small W, it feels to me like where they meet is a called value and how we determine what constitutes value. And in late capitalism, it's pretty obvious where those two things meet, but I think the purpose of a kind of conversation like this is how do we redefine that? And so, you know, we've been doing this, Jaden and leading the way, this exploration of alternative currency for the arts and what it would be to redefine how we value each other and what we bring to the table. And in the exploration of that, we've collected all these statements from people who are just saying what they have to offer as resources. And it's really overwhelming to read. Like, you go, you know, we have a lot of resources.
Right.
And we haven't figured out how to take those resources and connect the big W and the small W. And I think that's our 21st century challenge.
And also maybe in regard to emerging and young artists, to redefine the trajectory, because I think a lot of young artists think that the little W leads to the big W.
Yes.
And it's not always that corridor.
Yeah.
It's not always, oh, I train and go to class and then I get the big job and look at me. It's not, that trajectory is totally obscure these days. That doesn't matter. We have collegiate programs where students are jumping out and making their own companies and flooding the market and not sharing resources and not understanding that they're biting the hand that's feeding them by not knocking on their neighbor's door and saying, oh, you teach yoga? Can I have a yoga class for free and I'll give you some of my cereal? Like, it's that kind of cooperative communion. And I think there was a really beautiful generation of artists who really communed and weren't trying to build a community, because they were really communing with each other on a really deep, deep level that really was palpable, and that's what made a lot of us want to do it. And these days we're really trying to structure and destructure and figure things out in a way that, you know, my level of survival in academia perpetuates, but also there has to be some level of that gift and that resource that we can intertwine to figure out the work is the work, whether we think it's big or little.
And how do we work on community building? When people talk community building, what does that mean? You know, and when you come, and there's a difference between consultation and the difference between collective. And a lot of the times, if you have a space, and I feel the same way, we have a space in New York City, and it's a collective space. And it's a community collective space. And it can be a nightmare, because tribal nations are very opinionated people. They're peoples. We're very hard-headed. We come in, we talk. You know, you could be in a meeting, leave at sunup, and it started at 6. Because everyone has to make that point across. So it can, but at the same time, you see community pull through for one another when there's no resource. Because when it comes down to, oh, this space might close, what can we do now? We help, you know, and everyone says, well, that's politics. No, that's how you sustain survival in a community. You have to really go back to that organic grain. It's like raising children together. You know, it's like, you know, you help me out, and that's how our community has survived. So I think it's not collective. I think we say, well, we want to be in control of the collective. Okay, that there has to be leadership, yes. There has to be leadership. And I think a lot of times in Native communities, we're taught what everyone has a role.
Yeah.
Everybody has a role. There are people who fundraise, there are midwives, there are diplomats, there are artists. There, everyone has these roles in the structure of this community. And I don't think we're the only peoples who do that. I think it is something that we have forgotten over the years. Because if we are going, let's talk about environment for a second. If the environment fails, we're not going to be alone. No one's going to survive. So if we want to continue working as artists and continue working with our process, we have to use our collective community, which is the collective resource. I mean, that's even sometimes going down to somebody who went to the same college as you, and you've read in the newspaper, oh, they inherited money. So you call them up, hey, I'm doing this project. You know, and someone says, well, that's begging. No, it's not. This is somebody who was a friend of yours. You know, and I think that continues. You know, how do you do fundraisers? You know, what do? Do you do a spaghetti dinner? Well, maybe we have to think a little bigger than that. You know, where are the, with my community, where are the Native artists who have made it? You know, the big deal now is Johnny Depp. You know, is he going to give people money now? Because he did this horrendous movie. And everybody's wondering, you know. So I think that collectively, that's the only way to survive. With our theater companies and, our, and I guess the lack of a better word in nonprofit, you know, and yeah. The process.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm stuck on the little W and the notion of the value in between, and I think it's an amazing graphic. Like, I have been looking for that for a long time. What joins the little W and the big W value? And then you think, well, money, which comes up every once in a while. What Karl Marx said about, yes, I said Karl Marx. He said about money is that it's an equivalency. That's what it is. And this is profound to think what an equivalency is. In other words, this experience here is worth what? How much money? That's the equivalency.
Right.
My relationship is related to work. My work in your play is worth what? It's this equivalency. So an equivalency like money as an abstract, that's why we get so obsessed with it, because it's you can't fulfill that ever. You're always wanting more. So there's no satisfaction in that equivalency. You always want, which is why rich people always want more money. It's inevitable. But if you say, which is why I think that most Broadway shows are problematic, because the value in the middle of the little and big W is money. But if you say it's something else, mm-hmm. Although I have to say, and it goes back to training, when my company first came together, the actors got together and they said, what does it mean to be a city company member? And they immediately said training. In other words, it comes down to that they trained together. And at the same time, one of the first things I said as in putting the company together, I said, the number one value is that we pay the actors well. And so often we say, when we start a company, we say, we're going to pay everybody else well, and when we're in, got our footing, then we pay the actors. And I thought, I would like a company of really mature people who can have families. And so because of that choice of saying they have to earn a good living, we lost a lot of work in the beginning, 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. People would say, you want to do this, how much are you paying? Okay, it's not enough. It has to be a minimum of $800 a week. It just has to. And I think that's why the actors don't leave. And that doesn't mean we always got it. Sometimes the actors would say, you know what, we want to go to Tbilisi. They haven't got any money. We're going. We'll do it for free. And it's not, and it doesn't actually make things matter. But that's also a value. It's not the value is money. It's the value is valuing their time and not putting that to later. So it's not about ignoring money, but I just find that graphic of the big W, the little W, and the V, I guess, in between, I find completely useful and instructive.
Right.
Copyrighted.
I think the holism is sort of what the aim is. I mean, I think that's one of the main targets, or one of the main values. I know, for me, I came to Double Edge at a time when it was in a major transition. And also, at one point, Stacey even said to me, listen, we're probably going to have to close this. And I had been here for 2 years at that point and sort of saw that as an opportunity to have a break. Many other people were like, we will stand by you. We'll fight the band. And I remember I said to Stacey, you know, whatever you have to do.
About that.
Well, it's like, you know, sort of bamboo in the but at the same token, at one point, Arlo sat down with me and was like, listen, you're an apprentice. You're getting like that. You're not gonna get paid to be an actor. What are you gonna do? And it just like it ended up being in our Quijote production. There's no money, Sancho. There's no money. And then you're faced with that choice about, well, you know, training and, let's say, the research has this value, this sort of super value that feels like it takes me to my power. So how does that fit into the other realm? I know that's what the obsession of HowlRound is. I know that Clyde, the Latino Theater Commons, mm-hmm. it's another area of work.
Yeah, that's not paid work, you know, but it's rewarding work.
Right.
And you know, I told someone the other day, I said, you know, I think of myself as an entrepreneur, right? But what we've mixed it up, and I just read a book not too long ago by Chris Rapp called Invisible Capital, and it really transformed and it helped me think about my entrepreneurship not equating necessarily to capitalism and being about for money, but filling needs,
yeah.
right? Mm-hmm. Where is there a need to fill? And you know, the LTC work is where all of us that are putting in the work are filling a particular need, you know, for a particular moment, right? That's maybe the fix for, you know, another person to play with the language a little bit, you know, around a particular piece of art.
Right, right. I mean, speaking out of turn perhaps, but I think ultimately like a community has that same fix. Mm-hmm. The non, quote unquote, like the non-artists, I think, have that same need, that same desire for what we experienced in training or what we experienced in that process. And in that way, like the community becomes an extension of the ensemble. And I do think it's profitable. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would argue that.
I think this brings up another point that ties back to language of this whole new field of social entrepreneurship. And how it's kind of what artists have been doing forever.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And that it's two-sided. It's doing good. Well, there are books written about it, making good. But the idea is that this term, social entrepreneurship, can be wrapped around a business model that makes people feel like they're doing something sustainable for other communities, which is still then a them-us relationship. But it's also what artists have been doing in terms of investing in their own communities, not just outside of themselves, but as artists in general, and making it an entrepreneurial act for sustainability. So I think it's another way that this language is being re-envisioned or reimagined that's excluding the artist.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Another part I have to that question would be that if you've been talking a lot about language with the money side of things, but also part of what most of the people here do, and I've been unfortunately here the first half, but is you're creating art for an audience. And we're talking a lot about the language for money, but what about getting your art known, especially what you were talking about with a project that you're trying to involve the community in? How are you doing a disservice to your art by not changing the language to reach a broader community? I was here, I've been here with Double Light the whole time, but I remember we were talking about 3 years that we've really been in the community, and I do remember the change, and I'm wondering how the language can, yes, does it, as we were talking about, it does a disservice, because how can you make language fit what you're doing? But I'm wondering how language, not using it, is also a disservice, maybe.
I think that's a good point because, and it's actually quite concrete in a way, because each of us could empower or enlist our communities to invent language with us.
Mm-hmm.
We had a community meeting sort of envisioning what could be the farm in 15 or 20 years with, you know, an actual farmer, our neighbors. And one of the people who was here said that she always felt that this was a center for idealism. And that was not part of the language that I was using. And I think it's interesting to put that task of language rebuilding in the community and then share it. I think we might be getting to the end of this, but I wanted just to see if there's any last things, Morgan or Carlos, Mark.
I have a question. If there's a big W and a little W, is there a big V and a little V?
For Valdez.
Yes.
Yes.
And it's a general question. I started to see that diagram, yeah. And then I didn't know it. Like,
you know, I think there's just a B, and I don't think it's B or little. And I think I learned this from that film that was made about Garchanitsa years ago. Oh, Chiquita Gregory made it. And I remember San Antonio was actually showing it in New York. It was 150 years ago, and it was not so shocked looking in the mirror. And it showed how Garchanitsa went out with their carts and horses and went into villages, and they would say to the villages, this is before the fall of communism, obviously, say to villages, if we perform for you, we will perform for you in exchange for the fact that you will perform for us. And so Garchanitsa, you see in this film, performed, and then they turned to the audience in this village and said, okay, it's your turn. And Chiquita Gregory hones in on a couple of elderly ladies who are sitting there trying to remember nursery rhymes, because they wanted to sing the nursery rhymes. And Stanislavski stopped the film and pointed at the two ladies and said, this is the reason we do everything we do, is for this little moment to happen. And I thought, what's so great about that is that answers the question, do we put the garbage to the left or the right in the morning when we take it out? It answers it is from that B that every decision, small or big, administrative, artistic, whatever, it's all made based on that incredibly precise moment, which is why I think there shouldn't be a big B or a little B, because I think that would make it a hierarchy that's not useful.
So value is what it is at that moment, as it's being defined based upon the needs of the big W and the little W.
Yeah, I think it's just a little, that's probably a little B.
I don't know what it is. I'm thinking of the V just turning like a clock, and it depends on where it is or what axis it's on and how you determine value, because it's all about the work you're doing in the moment. And
you do know.
Right, and it relates to what you were saying about the Hawaiian way of using the words, like what is value for you in, you know, Middlebury, what was it before, you know, what is for me here, what is for Clyde, what is for anybody, and because, again, you know, I'm thinking about we're living in this kind of like umbrella English dominated world, which is kind of like the Latin, the new version of the Roman Empire. So people speak English in Buenos Aires, you know, and in Louisiana or in Indiana. People speak English, but they don't speak them necessarily. And I think value is when you start speaking like what you said about art, you know, it's when you are. And that's probably what we are here, or I feel that I'm called to do. I'm just trying to bring myself and bring some people into being themselves as well.
I'm tempted to throw in around this question of value. We're talking about kind of the, am I right? I was going to get water when I heard this. We were talking about Marx talking about value as equivalency.
Yeah.
Money is equivalency. Yeah. And, I'm a child of my mother, but politically, in a lot of ways, I'm a child of the Zapatistas. In terms of, it's just there's constantly a quote or something in my head. There's constantly a frame that goes there. And one of those quotes that goes through my mind in this moment, which I think relates to value, which oftentimes it's a question of, well, what's, is this more valuable than that? There's almost immediately a jump to a hierarchy. And there's a Zapatista quote that I'm sure is older than that political organization, which says, we are equal because we are different. Mm-hmm. And so in that kind of puzzle, there's this kind of question of, are the very thing that makes us equivalent, is actually our difference. So I think that has something to give to this question of value, how we produce it or how we recognize it.
Great. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
We'll take a break now and have some lunch. We will be having, what's the story now?
About 10 minutes, we'll be, 7 to 10 minutes, we'll be out under the tent. There'll be some lunch set up there.
It's almost 1:30.